Good morning and welcome to the 27th meeting in 2015 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Could I please remind everyone present to turn off any electronic devices that they may have. I've received apologies this morning from Jackie Bailey, and Gavin Brown will arrive a bit late. Our first item of business today is to decide whether or not to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated their agreement. Our second item of business forms part of our scrutiny of the Scottish Fiscal Commission Bill. Firstly, we'll take evidence by video conference from Robert Chote, Chairman of the Office for Budget Responsibility. And I'd like to welcome Robert to the meeting. And Robert will give us a small, short, brief statement. Robert, then we'll go to questions.
Good morning, Convener. It's a great pleasure to be with you. Apologies for not being with you in person. There ended up being a gap in the diary, but not a gap on the sleeper. Just by way of introduction, all I wanted to say is that I think that the Scottish Fiscal Commission is a great innovation and that we've already established a very good working relationship with them, as we have done with the Scottish Government officials that we deal with on the devolved taxes forecasts. I think one key lesson of international experience with fiscal councils is that there is no one-size-fits-all template. So I think in responding to your questions, I'm bound to focus on what has worked well or less well for us, given the tasks that we've been given. That may or may not be a good guide to how things would or should work in Scotland. I hope that, however things turn out, that the arrangements will be set up in such a way that we can cooperate effectively, as we're going to be having to answer some of the same questions, while respecting our respective independence. From our point of view, we're very keen for an open and collaborative relationship with the Commission and indeed with the Government. We invite Scottish Government officials and the Commission to participate in the meetings where we discuss our forecast for the devolved taxes, and we've found that to be very useful. And I hope that we can carry on in that spirit as the scope of devolution and the role of the Commission broadens. And after that, I'm very happy to take your questions.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that, Robert, and it's great to have you back again at the committee, albeit not in the flesh, so to speak. You said in that very brief opening, you said there was no template, and it was about what worked well and what hasn't worked so well. So for the OBR, what has worked well and what has not worked so well?
I think from our point of view, things have worked probably better than I would have anticipated when things were set up to begin with. As Ian Leanut's excellent paper makes clear, we're quite an unusual model in the sense that the whole task of forecasting has been contracted out to us by the government, rather than having a situation in which we are scrutinising the government's forecasts or producing parallel forecasts. That necessitates a relationship in which we have to have a private interaction with government officials in the run-up to budgets and autumn statements, and that I think has worked better than I would have anticipated. The working relationship is a good one. I think that it's interesting that there was a review of external stakeholders who said they, I was pleased to see, who said they had confidence in the work of the OBR. They attributed that to the quality of the staff and the nature of the day-to-day workings, and they didn't put a great deal of emphasis on the formal, legal and institutional underpinnings. I think it would be a great mistake to conclude from that that those formal underpinnings don't work. They are an essential backdrop, and the way in which the working relationship operates, I think, is conditioned, perhaps subconsciously to a degree, by the knowledge that there is that structure of agreed rules, of agreed working relationships there. I think in terms of what hasn't worked so well, I wouldn't describe it as not working so well. Clearly, that's it's a more difficult environment in which to demonstrate your independence, where there is that necessary discussion that takes place in private. When I used to be running the Institute for Fiscal Studies, it was slightly easier because the government would produce numbers and then after the event we would look at them and talk about them and say whether we thought they were too high or too low. There was no interaction. If we had that relationship, we wouldn't be adding anything to what the IFS does anyway. So I think it has worked. It's necessarily more difficult to persuade people that there is a clean distinction, but I think it's the only way we would have added value to what I'd been doing for the previous 8 years in the old job.
Okay, so given the position of the OBR and what you've just said, actually, do you feel that the Scottish Fiscal Commission should prepare its own forecast independently of the Scottish Government?
Again, we're relatively unusual in doing it ourselves and providing the official forecast. The Netherlands is the only other obvious example. I think that if you set up, as the Scottish Government desires, a situation in which they are producing the forecast and the Commission is scrutinising it, the experience I think you would find from the Irish Fiscal Council is that with time, you end up pretty much having to do a forecast of your own in order to be able to critique the forecast that you're looking at from the government. So I think there might be a risk in thinking to begin with that you can do this, as it were, looking from the sidelines without getting, involved in the mechanics of producing a forecast yourself. I think the Irish experience is over time that they've found that that was harder to do. It might also be harder to do in this context because you could argue that if, say, people were interested primarily in what your view of real GDP growth was, which is, is not our key role, but for the UK, there is a wide variety of other forecasts available in the public domain. And one way of viewing reasonableness of a forecast would be to say, I'm not going to do a forecast of my own and compare it to that, but say, how does it compare to the other forecasts that are out there? I think in this environment, for the things that the Scottish Fiscal Commission will be scrutinising and the SG will be forecasting, there isn't a wide range of other forecasts to look at. So once again, that would lead me in the direction of saying not necessarily that they should do the forecast, but that over time they might find themselves wishing to get pretty close to doing their own forecast in order to produce adequate scrutiny. To date, the Commission has focused very much on whether they believe that the methodologies are reasonable, which is a very sensible approach when the whole system is being set up to begin with. Once it's been running for a while, reasonableness will come down more to issues like, do you accept as reasonable the interpretation that the government has put on recent outturn data and the way in which that outturn data compares to the forecast? And that again gets you more into a parallel forecasting mode. So I would certainly say that it would be a good idea for them to have the resources to be able to do that should they wish to do that.
Yeah, so you're effectively saying that even if they don't actually have a role of actually producing their own forecast, de facto they're going to have to more or less do it maybe in 5 or 10 years or possibly sooner in any case.
Quite possibly sooner. A lot of this comes down to the issue of reasonableness. In the bill, the function is set out as to judging whether the forecast produced and the assumptions made for the non-domestic rates are reasonable. It will be for the Commission to define what they mean by reasonable. As I said, at the moment, to date, I think they focus primarily on methodology, very sensibly. But you get to the point at which you say, well, how do we define reasonable? Do you define reasonable in terms of a numerical range of outcomes for a particular forecast that you think are acceptable? And that range, I think, could be quite wide. And the Scottish Government at the moment doesn't publish five-year forecasts, but if you were to say, what is, from this point, a reasonable range for forecasts of the LBTT revenues in 5 years' time, that could be quite a wide range because it depends on movements in house prices, movements in transactions anywhere, and deciding where you draw the line between reasonable and unreasonable is not straightforward, but it's implicit in this model.
Now, obviously, you've looked at the kind of the bill in some detail, and you looked at the resources behind it. Do you feel the Scottish Fiscal Commission would have the resources to be able to do that? Because obviously, the OBR is much, obviously, has much greater resources than the Scottish Fiscal Commission has, or indeed is likely to have.
I think so. I think, as I say, I thought Ian Leanert's paper was an excellent one. I think he did say somewhere that he thought that the Scottish Government's assessment of the resource needs was munificent. I think from personal experience that the amount of resources you need to do this job properly may be rather larger than some people who haven't engaged in the process themselves think. So I suspect the Scottish Government's probably made quite a good judgment on that rather than an excessively generous one, but it will depend on the allocation there. I think from our point of view, you're right that we have more resources than are proposed for the Fiscal Commission. Obviously, we have a wider forecasting remit, but even the resources that we have, are nowhere near adequate on their own to do the job that we do, and it depends crucially on our access not merely to information but also to the assistance, time and effort of civil servants, in particular in the Revenue and Customs and Work and Pensions departments, to do our job properly. And in effect, we have about 120 people, quote unquote, working for us, particularly in the immediate run up to the forecasting events in those departments. So I think another issue for the Commission is not merely how much resources do they have to play with them themselves, but what degree of expectation is there about the time and effort that people in Revenue Scotland or the Scottish Government administration will be able to provide in assisting them with the information, with the analysis, going through the judgments that they've made. So it's not just a question of how much cash they have in the kitty.
Yeah, thanks very much. I mean, you've almost preempted my next question, which is, I just wonder if you can expand on the level of contact you have with the UK departments in private and the basis of those discussions, which you've just touched on to some degree.
Yes, I think, the primary area, if you were to look at who is devoting most person hours to in effect working for us, it's very much Revenue and Customs, obviously, on all the various tax forecasts, and Work and Pensions on the welfare forecast. Now, the key thing to bear in mind there is that the forecasts that we produce for welfare spending, for tax spending, are our forecasts. They are, providing us with technical assistance. They will make recommendations, for example, about whether the models that are used to forecast these things should be changed or not. At the end of the day, it's always our decision whether that happens. They may have ideas about how to interpret outturn data, but at the end of the day, it's our forecast and we interpret and we make that. And one thing I've been pleased about is that those relationships with officials in those departments are conducted on a very professional basis, and you very rarely get the sense of the sort of, the political spectre lurking behind the shoulders of the officials that you're talking to. And I'm very wary of any occasions when it looks as though the material that we're being provided or the assistance we're being provided is being clouded by that sort of political intervention. But as I say, to date, that's worked reasonably well. The other part of the relationship we obviously have is more with the Treasury, where, in a sense, they need us more than we need them. They bring to us the policy measures that the government is thinking of announcing at a particular fiscal event, and we scrutinise that and we have a debate over what we think the right numbers are. At the end of the day, the government can publish its own numbers, but obviously we are producing a central forecast. If we don't like those numbers, we'll put different ones in the forecast, and we're very transparent about that. So there is quite a lot of contact. I think one lesson perhaps here for the Scottish environment is that I do find the fact that Revenue and Customs is at some arm's length from the Treasury to be a practical and symbolic source of reassurance. And I think, I don't know what the relationship is like or will be like between Revenue Scotland and the Scottish Government, and to what extent there's that sort of degree of arm's length separation. If it is, I think that would be a source of additional confidence for the Commission in the scrutiny work that they're doing.
I mean, how do you feel about the Commission exerting significant influence over the forecast at the same time as providing an assessment of the reasonableness?
It's a sort of hybrid model that's being proposed here. As I understand it, you have an influence, and at one level, obviously, you hope there's going to be influence. The whole point of this exercise is that by having independent scrutiny, the government being scrutinised knows that and comes up with more sensible forecasts. I think, obviously, we have the whole debate, as it were, behind closed doors, and then we are producing the forecast on the same day. In the Scottish context, I think there's two issues. One is whether the Commission provides influence between the draft budget and the full or the subsequent budget, where I think they've cited an example where the Commission said that they thought that some of the assumptions that went into the non-domestic rates forecast were a bit over-optimistic, and the Scottish Government said, well, we responded to that between the draft budget and the subsequent one. So that's one way in which it shows up. The other way, obviously, is whether it shows up in the run-up to the draft budget forecast. And there, as I say, it seems to be a hybrid model. I mean, the IFS model would be to say you don't have any contact before the draft budget. The draft budget comes out, and then some while afterwards, you look at it and you say, well, yes, that seems reasonable, or that looks a bit high, or that looks a bit low, and you set out your expectations, and in which case you did that, presumably the Scottish Government can then decide whether to amend things afterwards. But which I think Ian Leanett leans in that direction. As I understand it, the proposal at the moment is that there is an interaction in private prior to the draft budget. I don't think there's anything necessarily wrong with that. I think it opens up the question of, again, reasonableness comes in. Do you want the system to work in such a way that the Scottish Government can have a private conversation with the Commission in the run-up to publishing the draft budget, which essentially they're saying, OK, if we published this, would you say that was reasonable? OK, if you wouldn't, if we published something slightly different, would you say that was reasonable? To what extent do you want that negotiation to be taking place in private? I'm not sure the outcome at the end of the day would necessarily be different. It's clearly drawing back again on our own experience. It might be harder to demonstrate and satisfy everybody that you were being independent if there's that sort of debate beforehand. But clearly there would be more opportunity to influence the numbers if you had that prior discussion rather than basically waiting for the draft budget to come out and then the Commission then looks at the numbers and draws its own conclusions to influence the subsequent forecast.
Thanks for that. Now, I'm just wondering if you think that the Scottish Fiscal Commission should perhaps have a wider remit to look, for example, at the sustainability of Scotland's public finances, particularly, for example, fiscal rules.
Personally, I see no problem with that. The way in which our remit is drawn fairly widely in terms of giving us an overall duty to report on and examine the sustainability of the public finances, and then we have specific requirements that are made of us in legislation and in the Charter for Budget Responsibility to produce particular reports. It seems to me that the questions you describe there are very good ones to ask, and it seems to me that the Scottish Fiscal Commission would be a very good set of people to ask them of. I guess it would depend in part on whether there are other university bodies or other research institutes that are doing that work in the way in which, for example, the IFS does it for the UK as a whole, and you therefore might argue there's no point having the Commission doing it as well. It's hard for me to tell at a distance whether there is that range of alternative opinion, but if there isn't, then I'd have thought the case for the Commission having the ability to talk about those things would be a good thing.
So you think the bill should perhaps be amended to reflect that, really?
Yeah, I think a broad overarching duty with a list of things that are required of it and a list of things that you're very clear you don't want it to do is probably the best outcome. And I think having setting it up to begin with, I think there's a reasonable case for having breadth to start off with, so you don't have to come back and amend the legislation if you do want it to go in that sort of direction. But I think the overall remit question is clearly one of choice, not of how it's doing its job. But my personal preference would be for it to be broader rather than narrower.
Thanks very much. I've just got one final area to touch on before I open questions out to the committee, and it's actually Dr. Jim Cuthbert, who will be giving evidence to committee following your own session, has produced, as he always does, a very interesting paper. And one of the things he talked about was basically about what he describes as a problem of forecasting Scottish Government's overall revenues, because only half the Scottish Government's revenues will come from devolved taxes. And he says forecasting the overall revenues will be a difficult task, quite unlike that undertaken by the OBR when it forecasts the UK Government's revenues. I'm just wondering, obviously the OBR is in a completely different position in terms of its forecasting. You can get your teeth into a lot more in some ways. Do you feel that situation, that the Scottish Fiscal Commission will face makes it more difficult to assess or forecast, to look further ahead at Scotland's finances, etc. How do you feel about that kind of position that the SFC is in relative to the OBR in terms of looking at finances and forecasts?
I think Jim raises a good point there. From our point of view, the challenge is, as you say, we can get into this in considerable detail, and at the end of the day, we are producing a completely comprehensive bottom-up forecast over a five-year time horizon. One thing it's important to say is that we are not producing a forecast of what we think the most likely outcome is going to be. We are producing a forecast of what we think the most likely outcome will be on currently stated government policy. Now, from our point of view, that requires us to ask the government to be clear what its policy is regarding, for example, public services and expenditure on grants over a five-year period. And for some of the time, when you're doing that, the actual concrete plans are only laid out for a relatively brief period. So at the moment, we're in the situation where we only have detailed spending plans set out for 2015-16, and we basically get the government to tell us transparently what they wish us to assume about the total envelope for spending on public services and grants over the subsequent 5 years. When we get to November the 25th, of course, that will be filled in for most of the Parliament. So I think one challenge, coming back to Jim's question, if you were doing an overall forecast for revenues for Scotland over a five-year horizon, you have to make assumptions about what you think the UK government's policy is likely to be towards grant spending over that period of time. From our point of view, as I say, we have to get the government to be as clear as we can get it to be about that. A challenge then for the Commission would be, do you take the UK government at its word? How do you interpret what they've said, which is not a full breakdown, so you don't know whether grants, particular sorts of grant spending, would more be more or less protected? Or do you basically produce on the forecast of how you think the UK government might behave over the next 5 years, rather than on what its stated policies are? So that does, I think, add in an extra wrinkle of difficulty, or a set of choices to make about how you do those forecasts.
Okay, thank you very much for that. I'm now going to open up the session to colleagues from around the table. And the first colleague to ask questions will be Richard, to be followed by Mark.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you, Mr. Chote, for your very helpful evidence this morning. You've talked about the importance for OBR of having effective dialogue with departments of government and with other government agencies as well, to do your job. And the right of access to information for our Fiscal Commission obviously is going to be a very important matter for them. We've already suggested that there should be a memorandum of understanding between the Fiscal Commission and other bodies like SEPA, Scottish Government, Revenue Scotland, too, so we can be reassured they will have the right access to information. But do you feel that something needs to be actually in legislation itself? I don't know what the arrangements are for OBR in this matter, if it has to be on the face of the bill, or if it's something that can be agreed between the Fiscal Commission and other agencies in another way.
I don't think it necessarily has to be on the face of the bill. It's not equivalently for us. But that's not to say that the Memorandum of Understanding isn't very important. I think it is an extremely important document at which all the participants in the process are setting out the expectations they have of each other in terms of what sort of information you're going to provide and when. From our point of view, it's in a sense even more important because we have to sort of get to a process at which we have a fully articulated post-measures forecast on the day of the budget. We need to sort of have set out deadlines by which, you know, the Treasury has a right to expect us to produce a forecast of what would happen if there were no changes at a particular point. We need them to tell us about the policies by a particular point for us to have time to integrate them later on. So some of those issues aren't going to arise for the Commission in the same way, I would have thought, because you're not having that, they're not doing the forecast. But nonetheless, I think the Memorandum of Understanding is very important and very useful. As I say, it's a way of setting out expectations. You don't necessarily want to be approaching it in a very legalistic way where you don't, you know, wave it around, but certainly it's always useful to have something as a backstop, and when you think you may be getting into disagreements, it's always nice to be able to cite the fact that we did have an agreement beforehand and this is the basis on which we've all set out to operate it. So I think it's a very useful intermediate step between the legislation at the top and the way in which the day-to-day working relationship operates, which fundamentally is the most important thing at the end. Having that set of agreements in the middle, I think, has been very useful for us.
Having those official agreements, as you say, has been a useful backstop. Have you had to use that backstop very often in terms of your own dialogue with other agencies?
Not a great deal. Sometimes, for example, there's a requirement in the set out that when the Treasury is providing commentary to us on the, because obviously we have an interaction with the material that we're going to publish where we need to check that we've correctly interpreted what the policy decisions that are going to be announced are going to be. And there is a requirement that basically says that, when the Treasury is providing input in that direction, it should be on the basis of fact checking, make sure it's right. It's not an opportunity to sort of badger us to change the opinions we've reached. And that's something that it's occasionally useful to remind them of, but it's not arisen as a serious problem.
And finally, from me, Convener, on the issue of forecasting, Mr. Chote, I'm sure you realise has been exercised in the committee quite a great deal, the role the Fiscal Commission should have in terms of forecasting. And I think your helpful evidence this morning suggests that perhaps should have that role or that ability within the Commission outlined at perhaps an earlier rather than a later point. But you said that at any rate, that role the Commission might develop in terms of forecasting in a few years down the line or even sooner may be something that they will wish to develop in terms of fulfilling their remit of assessing the reasonableness of forecasts. I mean, is it fair to say that they're not going to be working from a blank sheet of paper in developing that role? Presumably, they'll be able to consult with the OBR. Would you be willing to assist the Commission or advise them in terms of, some of the issues that it will find for itself in developing that role in terms of forecasting? You've highlighted not just the importance of resources, but the importance of building up those relationships with other people working in government, working in academia, working in other sectors. Is that something you'd be willing to assist the Fiscal Commission with, or was that something you think they would need to develop themselves?
No, we're obviously always happy to provide assistance, and certainly from our point of view, as I say, we found it very useful, both in terms of developing the additional methodologies that we've used, and then each time we're updating the forecast, to get the input of both the Scottish Fiscal Commission and Scottish Government officials at the point at which we're addressing those in each forecast. And that's crucially, as I say, partly when you start out on this process, and this has been true with the Commission to date, you're focused on the overall methodology or approach that you're going to use in developing the forecast. As time goes by, the methodology may not change very much, and the key issue then is how do you interpret the new news? If you have a forecast that says that a particular tax is going to raise £200 million a year over each of the next 5 years, and then in the first year it raises 100, how do you interpret that information? Do you say, well, that really means that we look at this and we probably want to conclude that the later year forecasts are too high? Do you conclude, oh, well, 200 a year is probably the best, so it may well overshoot in the other direction next year? Those sorts of judgments, those sorts of issues of interpretation are ones on which there's no monopoly of wisdom or folly. And, we will continue to have to produce forecasts for all the things that the Scottish Fiscal Commission is going to be scrutinising the Scottish Government's forecasts of. And I'm very happy to have an open, as open a discussion as we can about that. And at the end of the day, it's very important that we are independent. So, the Scottish Government should produce the forecast that it wants to. We produce the forecast that it wants to. It doesn't matter if those are different. What I think is useful is for us both to be able to have a shared understanding of why they're different and to be able to explain it to the committee, to other people who are interested. I think it's very important to make the point that you know, there's a world of difference between saying somebody else's forecast is different and somebody else's forecast is unreasonable. And as I say, it seems to me that the big challenge, you know, in initial interpretation over time is you know, what, how do you define reasonableness, particularly in a world in which you don't have a large cluster of other forecasts of the same thing. So you can't just say, well, reasonable is somewhere in the middle of the pack.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chote. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And marked before by John.
Thank you very much, Chair, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Chote. I just wanted to ask a couple of questions. You mentioned that the role of forecasting has effectively been contracted out, as it were, to the OBR. I just wondered in that respect, where are you the only ones producing forecasts at a UK level?
We're the only ones producing and publishing a fully articulated, disaggregated, bottom-up fiscal forecast. The closest comparator would be the Institute for Fiscal Studies in the annual green budget process, which I, you know, did for 8 years and is still going on. I think it's fair to say that they now place less emphasis on producing an alternative bottom-up forecast now that we do it, although they still provide very useful scrutiny of the work that we do, but it's not quite a sort of fully articulated alternative forecast as it was. Then in terms of the macroeconomic forecast, which is obviously an input into the fiscal forecast, there you do have a much larger population of people producing alternative estimates. There are roughly 35, the Treasury does a roundup every month of people's forecasts for GDP growth, inflation, balance of payments, etc. And there you do have a much larger number of people producing forecasts at a UK-wide level, and we make sure in our reports that we compare the latest forecast we've produced with the distribution and the evolution of those external forecasts. But on the fiscal side, there's much less of that. There are many fewer people who are producing those sorts of forecasts. So it's a very different story between macroeconomics and fiscal.
Because obviously one of the points that's been raised is around whether the Fiscal Commission should be producing alternative forecasts, or well, not alternative forecasts, but its own forecasts alongside those that government produces. And I just wondered if that was something that was occurring at a UK level, but you seem to indicate that in terms of fiscal forecasting, it's very much the OBR is kind of the only game in town.
We're the only game in town in terms of producing a bottom-up, a really big bottom-up forecast. City forecasters or academic institute forecasters do produce forecasts for example, the public sector borrowing, the headline budget deficit. I suspect that quite a lot of those start with our forecast and then say, well, we think it's likely to be higher or lower than that because we think that economic growth or inflation is likely to be higher or lower than the OBR is assuming, or we take a different view of oil prices or something like that. There are forecasts of the headline fiscal variables, but they're not generated bottom up from lots and lots and lots of different forecasts for particular tax receipts, for particular bits of spending in the way that ours are.
The Cabinet Secretary John Swinney has said to the committee that effectively the Fiscal Commission exercises a kind of veto, in the sense that if they say his projections are unreasonable, his view is he couldn't then continue with those projections, he would have to revise them. Is there a similar kind of check and balance on the forecasting that's being done at a UK level?
Well, in a sense, you have to flip it round. We produce the forecast, our forecast, based on our best judgment, and the government has to decide whether to set policy on the basis of our forecast or whether to say, actually, we think things are going to turn out differently, and accordingly, we're setting our forecasts in a different way. And to date, I'm sure they wouldn't accept every last bit of it, but the Chancellor has, on each occasion we've produced a forecast, said, I'm happy to use this forecast as the basis for the fiscal decisions that I've made and the narrative that he's setting out. So, for example, go back to 2012 and thereafter, we started to forecast that the government would no longer achieve its target to have the debt-to-GDP ratio falling in 2015-16. The government's response to that was to say, OK, we accept the forecast, But actually, we're happier to miss the target than to announce an additional fiscal tightening that would be necessary to hit it. So I think that, in a sense, is quite a, you know, it's a useful, transparent process. It demonstrates, for one thing, that we're willing to tell the government unpleasant stories, that we're willing to tell them that they're not going to achieve the things that they've set out to achieve. Secondly, it's absolutely right that it should be for elected ministers to decide what to do about that, and whether it's more important to hit the target or to achieve some other sorts of objectives. And also, experience has shown that that decision can go both ways. Sometimes we've said, you won't hit your target if you don't take some policy action, and they've taken some policy action to ensure that they do. Sometimes we've said, you won't hit your target, and they've said, fair enough, we'll have to live with that. We think it's better than the alternative. So, as I say, you're flipping round the area of responsibility. It's for the government to respond to us, not for us to respond to the government, which is the opposite of the way in which it would operate under the Scottish Government model.
But ultimately, and you've said there, it's for ministers to choose whether to take on board. Or ultimately, although it hasn't happened yet, the Treasury or the government could effectively disregard what the OBR has produced if they felt that they wanted to pursue a policy objective at variance with what you've suggested.
Well, I think the key thing there is they could say, we just don't believe this forecast and we're going to operate on the basis of... And then they would have to have a decision, obviously, of how much detail they wanted to set out in that forecast. And I don't think that wouldn't be catastrophic for the system. Reasonable people can disagree about economic forecasts. Anybody who's conducted them or read them or used them knows that. That wouldn't be a disaster. There's a separate issue, which is about policy advice. We very clearly do not provide policy recommendations. So if the government, in our view, is not on course to hit its target, it's not our job to say whether they ought to do what is necessary to hit the target or whether it would be better to miss it. Quite a lot of other fiscal councils in other countries, for them it would be part of their responsibility to say, OK, you're not on target and this is what we think you ought to do about that. That is not part of our responsibility, and I think it's the quid pro quo for having a very detailed role in the forecasting process with the interaction with government that implies, and the counterpart of that is that we shouldn't be providing policy advice. We're providing the numbers, and it's for other people to draw the policy conclusions from that. So I'm not sure, actually, from the bill, whether the idea is that the Commission should recommend particular policies or particular actions if numbers are coming out in a particular way, or whether, again, it's just saying, as I understand it, it's more about, are these numbers reasonable? Not, if they aren't reasonable, what should you do about it?
No, I don't think that's the suggestion. I don't think I was trying to imply that OBR would recommend policy or should recommend policy. But one final question, if I may. When we've looked at LBTT, there have been obviously forecasts for LBTT income produced by Scottish Government and also by UK Government via OBR. And those obviously were at variance when it came particularly to deciding the block grant adjustment. Going forward, obviously, Scottish Government forecasts will be subjected to the scrutiny by Scottish Fiscal Commission for reasonableness. I guess the question would be, what check or balance would there be on OBR or UK government projections to the same extent, particularly where those are going to be at variance with Scottish government projections?
Well, we will obviously be as transparent. We produce a very detailed publication explaining why our forecasts have changed from one forecast to the next. And as you know, we produce a specific paper looking at the details of the devolved tax forecast. When we're discussing those forecasts, as I say, we have Scottish Government and Scottish Fiscal Commission in the room via telephone more often than physically. So they're as we are discussing how we ought to interpret recent outturn data, why the shares have moved, was there any evidence on, for example, whether Scottish house prices are moving differently from the rest of the UK, those sorts of questions would come up. And at the end of the day, we will then produce our forecast. I don't think there's any need to worry if we have a different forecast from the Scottish Government, particularly on something like LBTT, where you know, that's, you know, taxes on property transactions are inevitably swing around a lot more than taxes on things like income and consumer spending, because they depend in part on house prices, which can move around quite a lot, and they also depend on the level of transactions, how many purchases and sales are taking place. I think, as I say, the useful thing is for there to be a shared recognition on both sides of the table that, you know, even if you don't come up with the same answer, that a sharing of information and understanding and a discussion of how you interpret the information is useful to us, and I hope it would be useful to the Scottish Government and the Scottish Fiscal Commission in producing the numbers that they have to do. I think for the purposes of the general public and for this committee, what I suspect you would most like is if the numbers are different, that when I come to you or when the Scottish Fiscal Commission comes to you and tries to explain why they're different, that we have a shared understanding of why that is. And it may be because the forecast was done at a different time of year. It may be because you're taking a different view of what a particular economic determinant of that forecast is going to do, house prices or transactions or something like that. Or it may be down to the fact that we've chosen a different methodology to produce the forecast on. But I'm very keen that we should have a free discussion about that, and that hopefully that the Scottish Government would see, you know, we obviously have a responsibility to the citizens of Scotland as much as to everybody else to produce the best UK forecast that we can. We're very happy to discuss the approaches that we're taking, the judgments that we're making, and I hope that the Government and the Commission would be happy to do that as well, because I think at the end of the day, you won't necessarily get the same answers, but we'll all understand where each other are coming from better.
Thank you.
Okay, John, to be followed by Jean.
Thanks, Convener. Obviously, we've covered quite a lot of ground already. I mean, Ireland was mentioned earlier on, I think, by yourself, as they had perhaps started off in one way and then, I think, I don't know if the word evolved was used, but had kind of slightly changed the way they were doing things and actually developed more of a forecasting ability themselves. And in some of the submissions we've had as a committee, it's been suggested that the SFC will just need to evolve, especially because we may get more powers in the future. I mean, has the OBR evolved over the years, or has it been very much a fixed entity?
It's been largely fixed. The main difference, I mean, the main additions to our role are when we had the Scotland Act. So we obviously, when we started out, we didn't know we were going to be doing devolved tax forecasts. We now are. So that's probably been the major change in the remit. The process, obviously the nature of the publications we're producing, we've tweaked that and refined that as we've gone along and been able to produce different sorts of material as we've gone further. The next change which we have coming up is that the Charter for Budget Responsibility has been revised in such a way that we're now going to produce a specific publication probably every 2 years on fiscal risks, which I look forward to discussing with Jim Cuthbert, among others, on how you would set about that sort of process, which a lot of other countries do, either at the level of their finance ministry or at their fiscal council level, which means, you know, bringing together a lot of the work we already do on things like sensitivity analysis and highlighting risks, but perhaps focusing that into a single publication. So those are the main changes that we've seen so far. The other ones that have been proposed for us, we should start looking at opposition party policies, for example, or that we should do distribution and analysis, have been raised at various times and rejected. But the core economic and fiscal forecasting role has basically been unchanged. We've developed it and refined it as we've gone along, but there's not been a big shift.
So within the remit that you've got the freedom to produce more reports or less reports, or how you produce the report, all of these kind of things, you've got freedom to do that?
The Charter sets out some things that we must produce. So we have to, you know, we were in a situation where we had to produce a fiscal sustainability report every year. We can now interpret that effectively as producing it once every 2 years, which will allow us to alternate it with a fiscal risks report. We are required to produce forecasts twice a year to accompany the budget and the autumn statement. We're required to produce a report that looks back and compares our forecast performance with what the outturns in data have been. But the additional as I say, the overarching duty, and we're allowed to fulfil that as the, in the way that we want to, has allowed us, for example, to produce a detailed working paper looking at why it is that the public finances evolved as they did over the course of the recession and the financial crisis and the subsequent improvement. We've produced papers looking at particular measures of inflation. So there is the scope to produce additional material which we think is helpful to our overall duty of reporting on explaining our views of the sustainability of the public finances. So it's coming back to the response I made to the convener initially. You have an overarching duty, some things you can do, some things you can't do, and then that's the context in which you operate.
And that's helpful, because that's been things that have been suggested that the Scottish Fiscal Commission should be able to do as well. I mean, another suggestion has been that Parliament in Scotland might ask the Fiscal Commission to produce extra reports or anything. Is that something that happens for the OBR?
It hasn't happened. Occasionally we're asked for particular bits of information, and obviously we try to be responsive, not just if parliamentarians, but other people are asking questions about the forecast that we do. Can we publish additional data, etc.? I mean, we don't have a pot of spare resources that means that we could regularly take commissions of somebody saying we'd like you to do a big report on X or Y. If people can make the case for us for saying that as part of our duties, wouldn't it be helpful to look in more detail at X or Y, oil prices, all these sort of things, where we can take that on board. But it's not as though we have a huge slush fund of uncommitted resources that we can deploy on particular wheezes that people come up with.
Useful. I suspect that's going to be the same for SFC. The whole question of relationships and the independence question we keep trying to deal with. And, we get different suggestions, because on the one extreme, you want a very interactive approach and influencing things as they go along. And on the other hand, it's been suggested to us that the SFC particularly should have a much more formal arrangement, and they meet ministers on particular days, and we all know which days they're actually meeting. I mean, how do you get that balance right? How have you found that in the past?
It's not straightforward to set that out in advance of actually seeing how the process works out in practice. We make a distinction between the interactions that we have with government ministers, their political advisers, their private offices, where we log on the website the meetings that we have with them when particular forecast material was formally passed over in one direction or another. So that's important and useful. But also we rely enormously on having a good interactive day-to-day working relationship at staff level between, for example, the officials in our office who look at the details of the revenue forecasts, and the particular officials in HMRC who are working on those sorts of forecasts. And it's very important to us that that relationship works unimpeded, that there's a mutual respect on both sides, that the people in the Revenue and Customs or the Treasury or the Work and Pensions Department, that we don't get the sense they're being lent on by their political masters in being willing to cooperate on that sort of basis. So there would be some people, and when we embarked on this process, my Swedish counterpart said that he just did not think that the OBR could be genuinely independent by having that sort of behind-the-scenes interaction. But as I say, if we didn't have that, we wouldn't be adding anything to what the IFS does already. In the Scottish context, there's a slightly different, as it were, opportunity, because you have a draft budget before a full budget. So there is a world in which you would have no interaction prior to the draft budget, then the Commission, and then that's an opportunity to take on board the recommendations. But as I say, I think the way in which it's seen at the moment is that there should be an opportunity for the governments to basically take on board advice at an earlier stage, so you end up with, quote unquote, a better forecast at the timing of the draft budget. But if you do that, you're in the world in which you have private interaction. So there's a trade-off to be taken between, how early you want their advice or recommendations or influence to be felt. And from your point of view, presumably having a timeliness of having a draft budget, which is a good guide to what you're going to end up, has attractions. But the counter side of that is, then you have the interaction in private in order for that to take place. So there's no right answer to that. You have to decide, where on the spectrum you want to be. We are clearly you know, because we're producing the forecast well at the end of the spectrum that has interaction, and that means it's incumbent on us to be as transparent as we can, both about the process and about how our forecasts have moved, to allay any concerns people have as best we can.
Yeah, I mean, that's helpful. I mean, obviously the Scottish situation is going to be slightly different, but you've obviously managed to get a kind of a balance, or you seem to be happy with it, and from what I can see other people are as well, between the interaction but maintaining the reputation of independence. I mean, do you think the reputation of independence is as much about the individuals and their integrity and how they're seen as a kind of formal laid-down process?
Well, it's interesting. That was certainly the conclusion when Kevin Page, the former Parliamentary Budget Officer, did a review of the OBR in 2014. He did a survey of external stakeholders, so think tanks, journalists, etc., etc., and said, you know, are you, you know, do you have confidence? And generally the answer was yes, and he asked why. And they did tend to say that it was more to do with the staff and the people and the way in which the work was done than the formal legislative underpinning. As I say, I think it would be very dangerous to conclude from that that the formal legislation and the formal rules don't matter. I think they do, and they're an important underpinning for that. The other thing in practice that, you know, that helps you develop a reputation for independence is obviously the first time you produce a forecast that says that the government is not going to hit the objectives that it has set itself, people say, oh, yes, right, they're more independent than I thought they were. There was an occasion when the Prime Minister misrepresented by accident or otherwise what we'd said about the relationship between austerity and economic growth, and I wrote an open letter. It was the lead item on the 10 o'clock news. That had an impact on people's views of our independence. Now, clearly, what you don't want to be in a world in which you deliberately go out and pick fights in order to demonstrate that, but I think it's the nature of doing the job that over a five-year period, you're going to establish enough occasions in which you've had to say things that politicians don't want to hear, that reputation can be built up on the basis of the way you're doing business year in, year out.
I think that resonates with this committee. We do that kind of thing as well, I think, sometimes. And the final area I just wanted to touch on was the forecasting. I mean, as I understand it, the Treasury forecasting has been contracted out to you, and I think that was the term that was used. One of the comments we got from John Swinney and the government was that if the Scottish Fiscal Commission was to do forecasts, the government would still have to do the forecasts itself, so it would be parallel forecasts. But from what I'm understanding in your situation, I mean, the Treasury is not doing parallel forecasts and then kind of checking up on you, is it?
Well, it's certainly not publishing any forecasts. They're not doing a sort of going through, you know, they haven't got the scene. It's not like man for man marking on a pitch. They've not got somebody doing the equivalent job to every one of our officials. Obviously, the Chancellor, I suspect, says to his officials, I'm going to get the OBR forecast in a few weeks' time. What do you think it's likely to say? And I suspect that they will, you know, not go through the whole exercise, but they're going to want to provide the answer to that sort of question. The Treasury may well do more sort of scenario analysis, you know, what do we think of particular risks, you know, to inform the policy judgment. So I think they, you know, it's not as though they've got rid of every forecaster that they have. There's nobody doing macroeconomics. There's nobody doing fiscal analysis. Of course they are. But the nature of the, you know, the way they can add value is different. And I don't think they add value by just completely replicating what we're doing. They're having to provide, you know, the Chancellor with a commentary on the way in which our forecasts are likely to evolve, and that requires them to be looking at them. But it is different from actually just having a parallel, you know, set of numbers. So, you know, in Korea, I think, in the United States with the OMB and CBO, you just have two sets of numbers that you can compare in public. That's not obviously the way in which it works here.
Thanks very much.
Jean?
Convener, Mr. Chote, I just wanted to ask, I guess as long as this country is not independent, there are, you know, a lot of strands to the kind of communications that go on. If you, Mr. Chote, were heading up the Scottish Fiscal Commission, what would you be recommending that your relationship with the OBR would be?
Well, as I say, I think the relationship would be one in which from the standing point of view, if I was, you know, my job was to scrutinise the Scottish Government's forecasts, what I would want from the OBR was such help as they were able to provide in forecasting the same things and being as transparent with the Commission about the way in which we're doing that, on the grounds that that would provide useful input to the Commission in scrutinising what the Scottish Government is doing. And we are trying to do that, as I say, as we do now. We think, hopefully, that it is helpful, in addition to being helpful for us, to have the Fiscal Commission involved in the discussions we do of particular forecasts ahead of each autumn statement, ahead of each budget. I hope that's also useful to them, because we are, in a sense, you know, they're not doing the forecast, but we're having to answer some of the same sorts of questions. How do you interpret the fact that the revenues of a particular tax came in higher or lower than we and or the Scottish Government were expecting? Is that news, or is that just volatility in the data? Is there some way of explaining that? If there is a way of explaining it, do you think it's going to persist or not? So, as I say, I think what I would want is the OBR to be as transparent as possible in how it was doing its job, giving me raw material that I could use in doing my job. And I hope that that's what we're doing. And if they feel that we can do more, we're very happy to do it.
Thank you. And given that there is, of course, you know, the rest of the budget, that the reserve matters that Scotland doesn't currently involve itself with, is there a relationship then with the new Scottish Fiscal Commission and the what used to be known as the Scottish Office? And how does that fit into the mix with the OBR?
Well, we don't have any interaction with the Scottish Office at all. I guess, again, it's depending on how widely the remit of the Scottish Fiscal Commission was set. It may be it may come to the point at which the Scottish Fiscal Commission would necessarily have an interest in, you know, more of our forecast than merely what we're forecasting for the devolved taxes. But again, we're trying to be as transparent as we can about that anyway. And, you know, if there were particular questions about the rest of the forecast, or coming back to the earlier discussion we had about the assumptions that we'd made about what was going to happen to government expenditure over a 5-year period, some of which would not be covered by a spending review, then there may be more areas of mutual interest. Needless to say, I mean, it's not a devolved issue, but there's been a lot of interest, as you well know from this committee and others, about what we've said on North Sea oil forecasts. But we hope to be as transparent as we can about those, as well as about the devolved taxes.
Okay, and finally, there's been some criticism of members of the Fiscal Commission in Scotland also being part of the Economic Advisory Group to the Scottish Government. Do you see any conflict of interest?
I wouldn't have said so. My understanding of the nature of the advisory group is that it's not very much, you know, involved in the detail of policy formulation, where you might have greater concerns. If they're providing external advice as academics, I suspect that's probably not too great an issue, and presumably the work they're doing that in that role is relatively transparent to the world of what they're saying and about what they're saying. I'm not hugely knowledgeable on exactly what they've done, but it wouldn't strike me to start with that there was necessarily a problem with that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, well, thank you very much. That's concluded questions from the committee. We just have a couple of final points I would want to bring to you, Robert. I'm just wondering if the Scottish Fiscal Commission is in any discussions with the OBR about the kind of methodologies you use in forecasting the devolved taxes.
Yes, well, obviously, when the Commission was set up to begin with, we had a discussion with them. And as I say, methodology issues arise whenever we're having, you know, a discussion in terms of the particular, you know, fiscal event that's taking place. Do we still think the methodology is working okay? Do we think there are particular reasons, for example, on those forecasts where we're identifying the Scottish share versus of the UK total. Are there reasons to believe that, you know, there are asymmetries, which means that share is rising or falling? Those are things that, you know, we obviously do discuss every time we do the forecast, and I'm very happy to do so.
And is there agreement on those methodologies and the way that they're actually deployed?
There's not an agreement on, you know, we produce our forecast and we try to be open and get the inputs into that as we can. The Scottish Government obviously produces its own forecast. They haven't asked us to contribute before they publish them to the discussions on those. But again, we'd be very happy to do that if they wished us to do so. I think for things, I mean, if you take the example of the LBTT, which is, you know, evolving from the costing of a new policy to something where you're going to be producing forecasts year in, year out, it's very useful for us to have a discussion about what are the best approaches to doing that. And obviously the Fiscal Commission has produced a paper in which they've talked about the methodology of this. When the changes were made, we explained in detail why we'd made the forecast that we had. And so thinking, you know, clearly in an ideal world, we'd have a shared methodology for producing the forecasts. And if we want to make different judgments about how to apply that methodology, or we're doing forecasts at different times of the year, the answers will come out differently. That said, you know, there's no requirement for us to have the same methodology. If we can agree on one that works for both of us, that's great. But if people don't want to agree on that, that's fine as well. As I say, it comes back to the point of ideally, we and the Scottish Government, helped by the Fiscal Commission, would, I think, ideally be in a position where both of us can explain why the forecasts are different, if they're different, but not to be particularly anxious about the fact that they are different. That's inevitable whenever you do a forecasting process.
Or if there's any difference in the methodologies, as long as you can explain exactly how you got to assess the forecasts in the way you have done.
I think that's right. I think one of the difficulties, I mean, LBTT being another good example, of if you did have different methodologies, working out from how accurate the forecast is, whether the accuracy of the forecast is a result of good luck or a better methodology, is very difficult. I suspect that whether a particular forecast of LBTT at any particular time horizon is more or less accurate in a purely arithmetic sense is going to depend much less on the particular methodology that's being used than on whether you happens to make the right judgment on the level of transactions, which is hugely important, these things. So I think I would be wary of a world in which you basically said we have alternative methodologies and after 2 or 3 years we'll have enough data to know which is the better methodology. Unfortunately, you need an awfully long run of data to be able to distinguish from luck and judgment. And normally, by the time you have managed to distinguish that, the policy's changed and you're not dealing with the same thing anyway. So, you know, it's helpful, but it's not a spot the ball competition.
Okay, one of the Commission's functions will be to assess the Scottish rate of income tax forecasts, or rather the Scottish Government's forecasts of Scottish rate of income tax receipts. I'm just wondering what level of access to HMRC data will the Scottish Government and the Commission require to do those forecasts?
Well, I think for them and for us, you respect taxpayer confidentiality. So there is a limit to how disaggregated the information that can be provided to you is. And as I say, we don't have access to that, and I wouldn't expect the Scottish Government or the Scottish Fiscal Commission. And the same issue arises for us with things like corporation tax, where it can be particularly important because you can have a relatively small number of firms making large contributions in particular sectors. I think the big difference, as we've discussed before, with the Scottish rate of income tax is that we're moving into a world in which taxpayers will be explicitly flagged as whether they're Scottish taxpayers or not, rather than relying on survey estimates of the Scottish share. So that will be, you know, of help to both of us, I think, in clarifying that looking forward. Obviously, I mean, one important issue, and who knows whether it will arise or not, is if we get into a world in which the Scottish rate is different from the UK rate, that starts to raise the question of how is behaviour on both sides of the border likely to respond to that. And that, again, is exactly the sort of issue where I think it would be jolly useful for us to have a discussion with the people who are doing the forecasts and scrutinising the forecasts in Scotland about what you think the answer to that question might be. But I wouldn't be at all surprised if people come up with different answers, because I think it would be a very difficult question to answer.
Well, in actual fact, we're going to be putting some of those questions to Professor David Bell in our third session this morning. So I'm sure we're very interested in that. I'm sure you will be too. Well, that's concluded my questions and indeed the committee's. Once again, Robert, I'd like to thank you for assisting the committee by giving evidence this morning. I hope next time we see you, it will be in the flesh. So thank you very much.
Great.
Anything else you want to cover that's not been touched on, or anything other further points you want to make?
No, I think it's been very comprehensive. That's covered everything.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Robert. All the best.
Thank you very much. See you soon.
Cheers. That being the end of that session, I'm going to call a 5-minute break for a change of witnesses, or in this case, a change of technology, and also to give members a natural break. Okay, we'll now reconvene the session, and next we will continue our consideration of the Scottish Fiscal Commission Bill by taking evidence from a panel of three witnesses. I therefore like to welcome to the meeting Dr. Jim Cuthbert, Professor Ronald MacDonald and Mark Taylor. Welcome once again to the Finance Committee. Members have received papers submitted by each of our witnesses, so we will go straight to questions. And the first question, actually, Mr. Taylor, is on something which we haven't really discussed this morning at all, so I thought we'd freshen things up a wee bit by going to that, which is paragraph 16 of your submission, in which you say the Smith Commission made a number of proposals about no detriment when fiscal changes are made by the UK or Scottish governments. This is likely to be difficult to implement in practice, and the Commission could play a useful role in reporting on the mechanisms for achieving no detriment. I found this a very interesting paragraph. I just wonder if you can expand a wee bit on the role in reporting on these mechanisms, how that would actually work in practice in relation to the Commission.
Certainly, Convener, happy to do so. I think I'd start with really the principles of where we're coming from and where the point's coming from here, and that's really we think that the Fiscal Commission will play a really strong role in giving assurance and helping transparency around all areas of fiscal estimation that affect the Scottish budget. And clearly, where the Smith Commission principles to be implemented, then the whole nil detriment principle and how that works will be one of the key factors in that. And we think that the Commission's likely to have a valuable role in playing and looking at some of that. How that works in practice, I don't think we've got any insight as to how that might work in practice. We might speculate there might be a degree of economic forecasting built into the way in which no detriment works, and therefore we think that there's a role for the Commission potentially in looking at that going forward.
Thank you. Do either of the other panellists want to comment on a particular issue? Jim.
Yes, I think it was a good point and I very much agree with it. And I think there's a real danger that discussions about the Scottish budget post-Smith just degenerate into a sort of yaboo exercise between the Scottish Government and Westminster. And it would be very important if the Scottish Fiscal Commission can play an independent and well-respected role as an arbitrator, in a sense, in that kind of dispute. Something like the role the IFS plays down south just now. If the IFS comments on a government policy, then that comment is generally taken very seriously and people think about it. And I think if the Fiscal Commission can play that role in respect to the arguments and debates about how the post-Smith fiscal arrangements are working, that would be valuable.
So clearly you see an expanded role for the Scottish Fiscal Commission. Would I be right in saying that?
Yes, very much so. I tried to make the point in the paper that forecasting the devolved tax revenues is going to be extremely important, but the operation of the remaining half of the Scottish budget is going to be very complex, and it's not something that's been done well so far. I mean, I was looking recently at a paper by the IFS on non-domestic rates, and you'll be aware of the point, but in the sense the IFS identified the problem that had been there and estimated that Scotland had gained to the tune of £1 billion, essentially because down south the government had been switching resources away from local authorities into central government expenditure, and as it did so, because the central government departments got a higher comparability percentage, we benefited through the Barnett formula. Now, that sort of thing, in a sense, slipped through under the radar. There'd be much more scope for that sort of point to arise than need to be identified and argued out, and I think the Fiscal Commission should be playing a huge role in that.
I mean, sticking with you, Jim, you basically said in the second paragraph, right at the start of your paper, you said the role of assessing risk should in many ways be more important than the actual production of forecasts. So that's really a continuation of what you've just said there, isn't it?
Yes, I very much welcomed what Robert Chote said when he said that they were going to be starting to produce regular reports on fiscal risk. And that's something which we've been arguing for some time. I think Robert gave perhaps a slightly too glowing account of the IFS's success. And I think in many ways the IFS has over-concentrated on forecasts. I may be doing him a disservice here, but I detected a slight shift in the way he was talking about forecasts, because as I recall, and I may have got this wrong, I always thought that the IFS represented their forecast as median forecasts. In other words, the outcome was likely to be as above it as below it. Whereas he definitely said in talking on television that the current forecast was the most likely outcome. This is very relevant because one would not, I would not regard the current OBR forecast as being median. The risks seem to be all on the downside. And I think if there's been a little shift of ground there, that perhaps is concealing some of the risks, the way that some of the risks around the current OBR forecast are lying, which would seem to be on the downside.
Now, Professor MacDonald, you've said, you know, in your paper, you said it would make sense for an independent body to assess the sustainability of Scotland's public finances and adherence to any fiscal rules devised.
Yes, that's right. I mean, just linking up with what colleagues were saying just now, I mean, we've covered quite a lot of ground there, I think. I agree that in moving forward, the no detriment issue has to be taken very seriously. And I know that you, Jim, have highlighted the risks associated with the form of indexation that we may have. So I think, as Jim said, in moving forward, I think it is important that some group scrutinises very carefully how the block grant is adjusted moving forward, for example. I mean, I have argued to this committee and elsewhere that we should move away from Barnett, and that would, I think, if we move to a more transparent and open system, deal with some of the perhaps trickier no detriment problems. So I think that is something that the Fiscal Commission could look at. So in general terms, yes, I would favour them to have a potentially broader role, because there's no one really out there who can do this as an alternative to the Fiscal Commission if it is set up in an appropriate way. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Now, I'm not jumping in about forecasts at one, because there's been so much time forecasting the last session. I'm going to try and leave some of that to my colleagues around the table. But one of the things that you've also said, Professor MacDonald, you've talked about independence, transparency. You said you'd give priority to independence, transparency and openness in the working relationship between the Fiscal Commission, the Scottish Government and other public bodies. And you went on to say, I think there should perhaps be a clause ruling out members transferring from a body such as the Council of Economic Advisers straight to the Fiscal Commission without any lag in service. Now, obviously, you've heard Robert Chote. He was asked a question about along these lines, and he basically said that as long as there's transparency, he doesn't see any difficulty, given the fact that the people who tend to serve in these bodies tend to be fairly eminent, well-respected individuals. So what's your feeling with regard to that?
Well, indeed, as I suggested in my comments, it could work both ways. It could be because they have been on the Council of Economic Advisers, they may want to be seen as even more independent than someone who didn't come from that background. So there's that side to it as well. I think the only point I was making there was that there may be a perception, and indeed I think there is a perception in the public mind, that if you've got a body which is advising government ministers, can they actually separate their advice from being purely independent? I mean, we know, for example, that the UK Chancellor has a group of economic advisers. He is a Council of Economic Advisers. Were one of them to be appointed to Robert Chote's job, I think there would be serious questions raised about that. Yeah.
Particularly from Robert Chote, I would imagine.
Yes, exactly.
Okay, Mark, in paragraph 5 on this same kind of theme, in terms of the Audit Scotland submission, you say overall the proposals in the bill appear to provide a significant degree of independence for the Scottish Fiscal Commission. This could be further increased by moving the balance of influence on appointments and financing further towards the Parliament. How would you see such a mechanism working? I mean, who within the Parliament would effectively fulfil this role, do you think?
I guess detailed questions of the arrangements for the Parliament are for the Parliament. I think there's similar appointments, Auditor General appointment, for example, where the appointment is made effectively by the Parliament, and she's a parliamentary appointment, and that's our experience, and our experience is that it supports the independence of the Auditor General role very well. The general point we make is independence is of course important, and having the Parliament more involved and ministers less involved help deal with some of the issues that have been outlined at the moment, that the perception of independence is as important as how that happens in practice. We also make suggestions, of course, which we may come on to, about how the funding works, and the same principle applies there, the perception around who has control over the funding and financing of the body is important, and we think that anything that moves the balance towards Parliament and away from ministers would be helpful to strengthen that. Having said that, a lot of what's in the bill really does emphasise the independence of that, and we give credit to that in our submission.
Thank you for that. Jim, in your paper you say, the Treasury should be added to the list of bodies with whom the Scottish Fiscal Commission will need to have a good and well understood working relationship. Just wonder if you can talk to us a wee bit about how you see the nature of that relationship working in practice.
I think the answer to that is I don't know, because the Treasury is a strange body. But in an ideal world, if the Fiscal Commission is going to fulfil this broader role, which certainly I would recommend and I think colleagues are recommending as well, of taking an overview of what is happening to the whole budget, and I think it's essential that it does that, then it will have to have assumptions on, for example, what is going to drive the Barnett formula, what is going to be the trend in devolved public expenditure, that is public expenditure and devolved services down south. Ideally, it would need to know a bit about how that is going to shift between different programmes. I mentioned earlier the importance of the Westminster government shifting expenditure from local government to central government and the effect that has on the Barnett formula. So it'll need to have information, assumptions on those aspects, and it'll need to have assumptions on the aspects which will drive the indexation, if we're going down something like the road of Holter indexation, which will be assumptions about the growth, for example, in the income tax base in the rest of the UK or the whole of the UK. And the only people I think who can give these assumptions are Treasury and HMRC. And Treasury will be essential because they will depend upon government policy. How willing Westminster governments will be to engage in a meaningful dialogue on those points and how willing the Treasury will be not to be a dog in the manger, I don't know. And how one secures the proper cooperation, I don't know. But I think it'll be very difficult for the Fiscal Commission to do a proper forecast of the overall Scottish budget without good relations with Treasury and with Westminster.
Okay, thank you. Now, you talked about the Holter indexation. In fact, much of your paper actually covers that particular issue, including some mind-numbing calculus, which you've actually put in there, which I'm going to ask Richard at some point to actually go through for the committee, but we'll do that in private session. But, I mean, you say in this, I couldn't let you away without mentioning that your quote that Scotland would always ultimately be better off under fiscal autonomy than under Holter indexation. I'm just wondering how you come to that conclusion, if you can talk us a wee bit about your concerns about Holter indexation.
Yes, I mean, the mind-numbing calculus was not primarily for your eyes. I mean, this followed from an appearance we had before the House of Lords Economic Affairs Committee, and I made the point there about fiscal autonomy, and the House of Lords asked for proof, and the paper there is the proof of that assertion. But this goes back to, you may remember, to previous appearance before this committee, I said that we won't know how the indexation is operated until it's modelled. And I then sat down and tried to do some modelling and published a Fraser Allender paper on modelling the indexation arrangements, which has been sent to the committee. And what came out of that was that Holter indexation, as originally proposed, is very unstable. The two main drawbacks, it's inequitable, because if the Scottish government set a neutral tax rate, set the same tax rate as in the rest of the UK, then Holter indexation would be neutral only if the Scottish tax base grew at the same rate as the rest of UK tax base. And given that rest of UK population is growing relative to our population, that would require that our per capita tax base grew faster than the rest of the UK. So there's an equity point. But there's also an instability point, that if we fail to meet that neutrality condition, if we fall below it, then what would happen to the revenues of the Scottish Government would they'd go down and down and down, and eventually, if the system's led to itself, would become negative. Now, that's never going to happen, but it's an indication of the pressures which, in a sense, are built into Holter indexation unless we meet this target of growing our tax base as fast as the rest of the UK. So, I was arguing to the House of Lords that Holter indexation was, in a sense, a non-starter. I was also pointing out that I made, a suggestion to this committee that improvement to Holter indexation would be to correct the indexation factor for relative population movement. And again, in the Fraser Allender paper, I worked through the implications of that. And that turns out to be a better, but not perfect, by no means perfect solution. It's more equitable in that neutrality is that we grow our per capita tax base at the same rate as the per capita tax base in the rest of the UK. It's more stable in that, under reasonable assumptions, the system will at least tend to, relative per capita spending will tend to a limit. But actually that limit is one that would not be politically acceptable, because it would imply that per capita spending in Scotland was about half the level in the rest of the UK. I was surprised when the figure about half tumbled out so neatly from the modelling, but it does. So what I was arguing to the House of Lords was that both pure Holtam indexation was very unacceptable, and that adjusted Holtam indexation was not really acceptable. And I was putting forward another proposal altogether, which was that maybe the indexation of the abatement should be based upon some fixed factor, that it is indexed at X percent in real terms, where X is some fairly modest, factor, say 1%. Now that would have big advantages. It would need to be subject to regular review, and the mechanisms for regular review would need to be well understood. And I go into that in a bit of detail in the House of Lords paper. But it would also have secondary implications for the problem we face of indexation. It would make the whole indexation and forecasting problem much simpler. We wouldn't need to have an assumption from UK Treasury about what was happening to the overall UK devolved tax base. We would just apply what the appropriate factor was at the time. So there are a number of big advantages, it seems to me, for quite a radical rejig to the indexation arrangements currently being worked out for the Smith Commission.
Okay, I'm going to let colleagues in just to comment on that, but obviously what we're talking about is the Scottish Fiscal Commission Bill, so we don't want to wander off the subject too much, but just what's your view on where the role of the Scottish Fiscal Commission could perhaps come in terms of these discussions and details, Professor MacDonald?
I agree with Jim's point there, and indeed I argued in a written submission, I think, to this committee before, that it should be a separate fixed factor that we index the growth of the block grant to. And I didn't do it in quite as sophisticated a way as Jim did it, but nonetheless the point was there. So I do agree that in moving forward it is very important that these issues are addressed, whether we retain Barnett, what the form of indexation is, and as I said earlier, there must be an independent body looking at this, and if there is no other independent body in town, then I think it would be good if the Fiscal Commission were tasked with taking these issues forward. Yeah.
And is that a view you would also share, Mark?
Of course, we'll not get into the policy choices that are available to how this works, but what's fundamentally important is it's clear how it works and it's transparent how it works, and the public have confidence in how it is working. And we see the Fiscal Commission has been able to play a role in that, both around and how the block grant itself works and how Barnett functions, if that continues to be the way in which that's operated, but also how the block grant adjustment works. One of the points we make in the paper is we have block grant adjustments now, and there may be a role for the Fiscal Commission now in providing some views on how that's operating at the moment, and it needn't be something that waits necessarily until the fiscal framework and Smith is implemented and considered.
Thank you very much for that. So I'll open up the session now to colleagues around the table. Quite a few are keen to come in. First will be Gavin, to be followed by Deputy Convener.
Convener, thank you. Good morning. First question is to all or any of you. When we get the next draft budget, which will presumably be at the beginning of next year, and we'll get the Fiscal Commission's views on forecasts for that period, is your view that we should get the forecasts for the entire economic period, if you like, or the forecast period, so of say 3 or 4 years, as opposed to just the single year of the budget that it sits alongside? I mean, is there merit in having medium-term projections instead of just single-year projections?
Well, I would argue yes, there is merit in moving towards a longer horizon, really for issues of sustainability. I mean, certainly the UK government has a medium-term budget forecast, and if the Fiscal Commission is to be charged with looking at say fiscal rules, which will presumably be about at least in part sustainability, then I think yes, the short answer is we do need to look at a longer horizon than the annual horizon they're currently charged with. Yeah.
If I could comment, I would agree with that. I think there are a range of different horizons, and it's not necessary to produce forecasts every year on all of those horizons. I mean, another requirement, which I think is very important, is that somebody looks forward every now and then 15, 20, 25 years and says, how are things going on present trends? What will the financial Scottish Government be like on present trends in 15, 20, 25 years? Because an authoritative view on that will be fundamental to long-term discussion about how Smith is operating, whether there need to be any adjustments to it, and will also be fundamental to the Scottish Government's long-term planning of its public expenditure strategy. So every now and then, when we need a very long-term forecast, more frequently we'll need medium-term forecasts, and obviously we'll need annual forecasts every year. So yes, different forecasts, but maybe in different time, different periodicities of production.
Okay. Thank you. Second question is, in terms of the bill itself, what's your view on having something in the bill relative to forecasting for the Fiscal Commission? Because as a bill is drafted, it doesn't mention forecasting at all in it. The Scottish Government have said various things over the last year, one of which previously was that they felt forecasting would be duplication. But last week or the week before, they basically said there's nothing in the bill to prevent the Fiscal Commission from doing its own forecasting. So there's slightly different positions over different times. But I suppose my question is, do you think something needs to be in the bill so that regardless of who's in government, there's a clear steer for what the Fiscal Commission should be doing? Or is it something that can be left out of the bill entirely and it's just a case of the Commission deciding what to do?
Well, certainly I said in my written submission that there should be something in the current bill, even if they don't do it in the short term, the forecasting. It's a tricky one because I think in the short term, and again I put this in my written submission, that Scotland's a small country. We know from previous discussions with this committee that there are data limitations within Scotland. It's only a halfway house was how one of the civil servants put it. So there are data limitations. So that means that any forecasting model that's going to be produced, I think, is going to be relatively small, relatively tractable. And if the Scottish Government are already building and working on that model, it seems to me with these data limitations that if we say to the Fiscal Commission that you've now got to start building a model, it might end up as being a very similar model, especially with the data limitations. So my argument is you have a kind of tapered approach that in the short term, the Fiscal Commission is a scrutineer of the Scottish Government's model. But in moving forward, if the Fiscal Commission is to be truly independent, it should be able to produce its own forecasts. And as we move forward, presumably the data will become available to make what would be perhaps an alternative model to the Scottish Government's forecasting model. And then perhaps in the longer term, the Scottish Fiscal Commission becomes a bit more like the OBR. It maybe is charged with doing all the forecasting, because in the longer term, it seems to me that if the forecasting becomes more sophisticated, I don't really see the point of the duplication of the forecasts if the Fiscal Commission is to be a truly independent body.
Okay.
If I may, convener, just to come back on that question, I think from our perspective, what's fundamentally important is that it should be open to the Scottish Fiscal Commission how best to assess reasonableness, and the bill should make sure that that independence is protected. And we think there's possibly some risks in overprescribing how it does that in some way. I think the sentiment of the conversation today, and I think it was reflected this morning, is the real opportunities for how that might develop over time. And I think making sure that the role of the Fiscal Commission and its independence being protected in the bill, I think you got some reassurances about that from government at the last meeting, is fundamental to how that works in practice.
I agree with what colleagues have said. One could obviously argue this both ways. I think the important thing is that the remit of the Commission should be broad, so that if it wants to forecast, it can, and that it be resourced appropriately. And certainly I would argue that it should be itself be producing long-term forecasts from time to time. But there are certain dangers with the forecasting rule. It's resource-intensive, there's the duplication point, and also if you're concentrating on forecasting, in certain circumstances, this tendency where you assume that you tend to assume the success of policy perfectly legitimately and underplay the uncertainty surrounding what's happening. So, you know, there are arguments in both directions. So, have the remit broad and resource it well.
Okay, thank you. Okay, moving on to another area. Both Professor MacDonald and Mr. Taylor made the point that we should specify the length of office period for commissioners on the face of the bill itself. So you both expressed that view in your written evidence. Is that something that you feel strongly about, or is it just something that on balance you think ought to be done, or is it something that is, in your view, absolutely critical that it's on the exact number of years would be on the face of the bill?
I think it's important, again, just in terms of the transparency and independence of the group. And I think there has been mention, I think the Cabinet Secretary indeed mentioned that there should be a separation between the political cycle and the appointment cycle. And I think that is very important. So, yeah, I see no reason why it shouldn't be stipulated on the bill.
Just to clarify, Mr. Brown, the intent of our submission isn't to say explicitly there should be a number in the bill, it should be X number of years, but rather that the bill enshrines the principle that the cycle of appointment should be independent from the electoral cycle. There's a number of ways, I guess, that can be drafted, so it's not about necessarily saying a number, but enshrining that principle that it's not an appointment, and that this hasn't been a practice in this country, but it's not to say it might not be in the future. It's not an appointment. It starts at the end of a political period and ends at a political period. That operates entirely independent of the politics.
Okay, no, fair enough. Thanks for that. Thanks for the clarification. I'll stick with you for now, Mr. Taylor, if that's okay. Just another interesting comment I think Audit Scotland made in their report was that they questioned whether we might try to shift the balance of influence away from the Scottish Government to more towards the Scottish Parliament. It was paragraph 22 seemed to sort of capture that best. Can you just expand upon what was behind that and how specifically could that principle be applied?
Touched on this with the convener earlier on. I think our thinking is that the perception of independence is as important as the practice of independence here, and a way in which, rather than the Parliament having a veto on ministerial decisions to appoint, that while both ministers and Parliament have an interest in who the appointments are, that ultimately those are parliamentary appointments. And I think our suggestion is that if that balance can be shifted towards Parliament, I think that would strengthen the perception and of independence, which we think is important to this role.
Okay, when you say shifting it to Parliament, in practical terms, would you envision, for example, the Finance Committee having a more proactive role earlier on in the process, or are you meaning Parliament as a whole?
So again, I wouldn't like to prescribe how Parliament might go about this, but I would expect it to be at a committee level. Yeah. And obviously, the way things are currently constituted, the Finance Committee is going to have a significant interest in that.
Sure. Okay. And just last issue, Dr. Cuthbert, just in terms of your own evidence, you made the point that something that comes into the bill, you don't feel that a copy of any report should go to ministers first. Can you just expand on that point?
Yes, I think ministers, if there are close working relationships at working level between the Fiscal Commission and civil servants, and I think that there should be, it would be desirable there are, then ministers should have a pretty good idea of what any report is likely to contain. But I think giving them a copy too soon in advance would open the door for them on occasion to try to influence what's coming out. So I suggest a courtesy 24 hours, but a courtesy fairly short period I think would be appropriate.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you. Clear, thank you.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Mark.
Thanks, convener. We've touched on it already, and we touched on it with Mr. Chote earlier on, the whole question of if there's two bodies doing the forecasting, the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the government, that would be duplication. Now, his answer to that seemed to be that the UK government, UK Treasury, was not doing forecasting, or at least was just doing little bits to challenge the OBR. And clearly there is a resource implication here, because Dr. Cuthbert, you said the Scottish Fiscal Commission should be resourced appropriately, kind of if they wanted to do their own forecasts, but that could be quite a sizeable resource. So that would leave us in the position of, if they're going to do forecasting, they need a lot more resources. If they're not going to, they don't need so many. And I'm just wondering how we kind of work our way around that.
I think probably the answer is much as is done with the OBR. I mean, in a sense, the OBR is the forecasting body. But as Robert Short said, there's 120 civil servants in Whitehall who at appropriate times are working away doing this. And initially when the OBR, I don't know what the current situation, when it was set up, they used the Treasury model. And it was important that they developed the capacity to run that Treasury model themselves, which I think they have. But there is a very strong symbiotic relationship between the OBR and Whitehall, as I understand it. And you couldn't really say that the OBR is doing independent forecasting with that input. And I see nothing wrong with working towards a similar model here. And I think a safeguard would be if the emphasis was not so much just on the production of a forecast, but on, yes, a forecast, whoever's producing it, whether it be the Fiscal Commission or government, but what the Fiscal Commission is doing as well is producing a very reasoned assessment around that forecast, saying here are the judgments that have gone in, here are the risks attaching to these judgments. On balance, we think that although that forecast is reasonable, there are significant risks of this or of that. That sort of assessment around the forecast would, I think, increase the authority with which they were regarded. It wouldn't matter so much who was actually producing a forecast or how that forecast was produced.
OBR's not really completely independent and can't be.
I think de facto that is the case. And this is no criticism in the sense of their bona fides, but they are working extremely closely with government. I mean, a lot of the input that they're getting is from government. As Robert says, 120 civil servants on occasion working in Whitehall for the OBR or with the OBR. So in those circumstances, inevitably, there'll be a lot of cross-fertilisation. And this is not political influence, it's just cross-fertilisation. The forecasts that the OBR produce must be influenced by government thinking. And there's also the question, a point I mentioned to you before, that when you're forecasting certain things, in a policy-influenced environment, usually the rational forecast will be on the success of policy, because you're aware that there is somebody out there pulling levers to try to bring about a particular end, and unless you have very strong reasons to believe that those levers have become operational and the ship is actually going to hit the rocks, the rational forecast is that policy will, the policy will succeed. The OBR has always assumed that at the end of the five-year forecasting period, the government will have got the economy back on track and they're operating at full capacity in a low inflation environment. Now, that is a forecast that has been successfully pushed further and further back. And it's not that they're politically dependent in making that forecast. In a policy-influenced environment, usually that is the rational forecast to make. So for both those reasons, the OBR forecast is not truly independent. And that is no criticism whatsoever of the bona fides of the OBR people.
And if I understood Mr. Chote correctly, if the OBR makes a forecast, the main people who would challenge that would be the IFS, and they would question the OBR forecast. So in our case, if it was the Scottish Fiscal Commission producing the forecast, who would challenge the Scottish Fiscal Commission?
Well, that is where my own view would be, that there should be less emphasis on the forecast. And it doesn't really matter who produces the forecast, whether it is the Scottish Government or the Scottish Fiscal Commission. The important thing that as well as the forecast, there's a reasoned assessment. Look, we've done some sensitivity analysis. Here are the key parameters surrounding this. Here's the sensitivities to variation of these parameters. Here's the risks attached to these parameters. And beyond that, there are sort of black swan events which whose timing no one can predict, but they are out there, and here's an assessment of what might happen there. And if you had that sort of reasoned assessment surrounding the forecast, it doesn't really matter so much who is producing the actual forecast. You're getting that understanding round about it.
I don't know if either of the others of you want to comment on that. I mean, Professor MacDonald, you used the word evolution, I think, and I picked up on that, and I asked Mr. Chote about that. Is that kind of how you see it, that actually we don't want a fixed picture here, we want something that's going to develop?
Well, that's how I saw it. I saw that obviously the Scottish Government already started on their forecasting model. For various reasons, which I mentioned earlier, I expect it'll be a relatively tractable, a small model. So if you were to ask the Fiscal Commission to produce a model, they'd probably end up with something which was quite similar. So in the first round, I would envisage that the Fiscal Commission would simply be commenting and criticising the Scottish Government's model. Now, as you move out from that, it may be the choice will be to develop their own model, and they should have, as we said earlier, the ability to do that. It may be that they decide to stick with developing the Scottish Government's model. And in broad terms, I agree with Jim's point that as long as there's transparency about the model, the assumptions particularly that are made, and the uncertainty with which we regard these assumptions, then in a sense, either group could be running the model. Because at the end of the day, I think one has to remember that, and I think this summarizes what Robert Chote was saying, that forecasting is as much an art as a science. It's as much, we can't write down an economic model, press a button, get some results out, and we then take these results. Even if the world were certain, that wouldn't work. there has to be some art, and the art comes around the assumptions that are made with respect to particular, say, coefficient numbers that the data throw up, which we don't regard as reasonable, and so we have to make some assumption about them, which gives us reasonable forecasts. So I think as long as the art, the assumptions part, is transparent, then in a sense, either group could actually do it. But what I think I was saying is that really, in the longer term, we don't need duplications, so there should be a choice between either the Scottish Government continuing to do it or the Fiscal Commission. My own view was that if the Fiscal Commission were an independent group, it may be better to let them take over the running of the model in the longer term. If they do, then we get into the kind of issues that Jim mentioned with respect to, well, you're going to have civil servant involvement with the group anyway. But my view is that that wouldn't necessarily compromise its independence, because a lot of what that's about, and I think this is what Robert Chote was getting to, although they have a lot of people in the civil service working for them, it is a big model, of course. It's a huge model. It's a model of the whole of the UK economy. And really, they're providing data. They're providing data, as he said, on customs and excise data and pensions data. Now, presumably, there are assumptions hidden in there, which perhaps the OBR don't see. But the big assumptions, I think, will be made by the modelling group itself. And so in that sense, I think they will be independent.
OK. Did you want to come in? Because I was going to ask you something, Mr. Taylor, but do you want to say something on that as well?
Very briefly on that. I think on the fundamental policy choice, is it government or is it the OBR, is it the SFC that does the forecast? I guess that's clearly a political choice. I think if the policy position is the government does the forecast and the OBR, the SFC assess reasonableness, our point is that the legislation should not box in the Commission and how it assesses reasonableness, and to have anything in the legislation that says, but you can't do forecasts, would be strange to put the Fiscal Commission in the position where it might say, well, the best way for us to do this is for us to do our own forecasts, but the legislation won't let us. Now, that's not what's in the legislation, but I think that's the point we were making around that.
I mean, the other angle that we have here is the cost of the whole thing, and that's where the more flexibility you have, the less certainty we have over cost, which becomes a problem for this committee as well. But, I mean, presumably the answer to that would be that, well, if the Scottish Fiscal Commission have a couple of years in the present situation, and then they could come back and ask for more resources, I guess.
And I don't think anybody's suggesting a blank cheque here, and that organisation will be subject to the strictures of public finance, as we all are. But there's something fundamental about who makes decisions around resources, and whether the government is placing itself in a position, or future governments in a position, where it can restrict the ability of the Fiscal Commission to do a proper job. And I guess where those decisions make, our point is fundamentally important to that.
Okay, thank you. Now, the point I was going to raise specifically with you was, in your report, you talked about independence and the whole concept of independence. And I wanted to ask you about that, because you say, well, Audit Scotland, the Auditor General for Scotland, the Accounts Commission, are all set up in a way that establish their independence from Parliament and government. And you've given some kind of practical issues as well. But, I mean, is it the structure that makes Audit Scotland? I have to say, I think in my opinion, a lot of people's opinion, Audit Scotland is seen as being independent, quite a strong challenger of different parts of government. I mean, does that come about because of the structure and the rules that are set down, or does that come about because of the professional attitude of your staff?
The short answer to that is both. And I think the structure is important, and I think Robert Chote said that earlier, and I think I'd agree fundamentally with that. Of course, the structure is important, but also the behaviours, and in an audit context, the ethics that we apply in carrying out our work, the culture that we have in Audit Scotland is that has been given fundamental importance, and will continue to be given fundamental importance, and that conditions how we do our work, and allows us to have the engagement with government and others in the course of the year, and yet protect and maintain that independence. I think the view that we have and the experience that we have is that level of engagement has actually helped reinforce our effectiveness as auditors, and helps in effect reinforce our independence, because we've got a better handle on what's going on and are able to discuss some of the nuances of issues as they come up, rather than have a more kind of stilted formal approach where the independence is tried to be enacted in the rules that go around that relationship. So short answer is both.
Okay. If we could move to just tease that out a little bit more, because, I mean, we've said that appearance is important as well as the reality of independence. And, I mean, as I understand it, in some cases, an auditor would be in visiting the client or interacting with the client on a very regular basis, maybe even weekly, right throughout the year. I mean, if there's that much interaction, is there always going to be a danger that people don't see that as independent?
So I guess that what we're clear about and how we manage that interaction is the importance and the cultural importance of independence and how we go about that. We also have a number of practical rules as to how that happens. I think our experience of that is that that interaction is fundamentally important to us, our ability to do our job well, and being able to do our job well by having that interaction on an ongoing basis. We're always clear, the relationship is always clear, the professional duties on both parties are always clear, and that ultimately we stand or fall by what we report at the end of the day. And I think you've given recognition to, I think there's a strong recognition to the sort of reports that Audit Scotland prepares, the sort of audit work that auditors do on behalf of Audit Scotland. It really demonstrates that independence.
You used the phrase culture of independence. Where did that come from? How did you get that?
So I think there's some organisational mechanics, which of course there are there about value statements and the like, but there's something that is very precious to both the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission and how they operate and how they expect us as Audit Scotland to operate, that is reflected in ways of working within the organisation. That's something that is established, and the tone is set, I guess, in legislation, going back to the establishment of Audit Scotland in the year 2000, but also is something that's embedded in the audit profession and the way in which the audit profession operates and the ethics that go behind the work that we do. So, yes, the legislation is important to create that. The tone of the political discourse around what's this body set up to do is important to create that, but then there's an ownership of that that sits within the organisation itself, and expect as Scottish Fiscal Commission continues to operate, becomes a statutory body and continues to protect and engender that independence, that it will do a similar thing.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mark, to be followed by Richard.
Thank you very much, Convener. We've covered quite a lot of ground already, but there's a couple of points I just wanted to pick up on. Dr. Cuthbert, you spoke about the relationship that the SFC would need to have with the Treasury, and I just wondered, following on from the evidence we received from Robert Chote, where his view appeared to be that the relationship essentially boiled down to forecasting on devolved taxes, but it appears from the submission that you've given that there's a wider consideration here around the impact on the block grant, which obviously will then have an implication for forecasting and also for the policy around taxation, but the forecasting as well. I just wondered if you wanted to maybe go into a bit more detail around that.
I think it's an important point. The role which OBR has is very much simpler in some respects than the role of a body which is trying to forecast the budget of the Scottish Government. I mean, the OBR takes effectively government's expenditure forecasts and then looks at the if forecasting, it has to forecast the economy and then has to forecast various tax revenues. So it's fairly simple. But in the Scottish context, if you're forecasting the Scottish budget, you've got the devolved Scottish taxes, but then you've got to forecast the operation of the Barnett formula, and already gone into some of the difficulties involved with that. And these are things which have not been done well in the past. I mean, the operation of the Barnett formula has been a bit of a mystery, and what should have been quite predictable of what was going to happen, the Scottish Government's finances were not picked up. There's other aspects as well which are less predictable, like, as I said, the shift in Whitehall between expenditure and local government and central government responsibilities. And then you've got the additional complexities about forecasting the operation of the indexation of the abatements for devolved taxes, and then the further difficulties about forecasting the abatements for the no detriment principle. So that is actually going to be quite a very complicated process, and a lot of the relevant assumptions will come from Treasury about the evolution of devolved expenditure down south, about the evolution of the tax base down south, and so on. So, you know, a very close working relationship with Treasury would be essential if you're going into that full kind of forecast.
I just wonder, therefore, I mean, obviously there's been talk around the memorandum of understanding that will need to exist between SFC and Scottish Government and Revenue Scotland and others as well. I just wonder whether your view would be then that the Treasury needs to have an MOU with the Scottish Fiscal Commission in order to enable it to get hold of the data it requires.
Absolutely. If the Scottish Fiscal Commission has got this broader role, which I think, you know, the general view coming through today has been that it should have this broader role, then it absolutely should have a member of understanding of the Treasury about the data that's required.
I just wonder, but Professor MacDonald, first of all, I wonder if you would agree on that, because I know you talk about the MOU in your submission, but you also talk about an arbitration mechanism beyond the MOU, which would enable there to be enable disagreements over reasonableness to be dealt with. I just wonder if you want to go into some detail as to how you would see that working and whether that's something that needs to be on the face of the bill or whether it's something that should be developed beyond the legislation.
Yeah. Well, on the first point, I'm in broad agreement with what Jim said. I mean, obviously, there will need to be, if things go ahead as they appear to be going ahead at the moment, then there will need to be a considerable involvement with HMRC. And so, for that reason, I think there should be a memorandum of agreement with them. The second point is with respect to the point I picked up. I had perhaps a quibble, I said, about the term reasonableness in the Scottish Fiscal Commission's access to data or information from the Scottish Government. So what I was saying there is, well, what happens if the Scottish Government says, well, we don't think that's a reasonable request? There doesn't appear to be any form of arbitration at the moment in any of the documents as to how they would address that issue. So I think all I was flagging up there is that if the committee were to think that that was an issue, that we should maybe, or you should maybe think about how a rejection of a request for something which was unreasonable could actually be addressed.
In terms of the periods of office, I note that going beyond the idea of establishing the term limits within the legislation, you've said that rather than just one term, the opportunity to serve two terms should be available. Is there any particular reason that you've suggested that?
Not really. I think other groups do it. I think it's practice with the OBR. It's certainly a practice with the Bank of England's Monetary Policy Committee. I think if someone seemed to have made a good job of the period in office, then there's no reason why they shouldn't be reappointed for a second term. So I wouldn't rule that out.
Okay. Just in terms of the trying to think of the best way to question this one. In terms of the Barnett implications that Dr. Cuthbert has identified, and I think you identify that as well in terms of the assessment that would need to take place. I mean, there are many people throughout history, I think Dr. Cuthbert has said, who have tried very hard to predict what will happen as a result of Barnett with limited success. How open do you feel that the Treasury will need to be in relation to Barnett in order for there to be meaningful assessment of the Barnett mechanisms and the implications of that?
Well, we'll need complete transparency in all of the kind of assumptions that Jim mentioned with respect to spending on devolved spending, non-devolved spending, the whole issue of indexation. There'll need to be complete transparency across all these ranges that impinge on Scottish revenue. And again, you know, you alluded to the point that Barnett is not a transparent block grant system, and that's why I and others have argued that we should be moving away from that. And it's maybe something that the Fiscal Commission should be charged with, along the lines of, say, the Australian body that looks at how the block grant should be evolved, how it should be defined in the first place, and then how it evolves over time.
That's the Australian Grants Commission.
Yeah, exactly.
I guess the final question, and I'll probably put this to all the panel, in terms of the idea that's been suggested, I think it was Dr. Cuthbert who suggested about the SFC having an arbitratory role between Scottish Government and Treasury. Obviously, when we produced our report around the fiscal framework, we did say that there needed to be some form of arbitration mechanism where disagreements arose between Scottish Government and Treasury. And I guess the question I would put is, one, do you agree with that? And two, would you see SFC as the vehicle for that? Because I would have some reservations about SFC being asked to be commenting on Scottish Government forecasts, but at the same time being asked to effectively, you know, hold the jackets between Scottish Government and Treasury. So I just wondered.
Can I just start by clarifying? I didn't mean it should in any sense have a formal arbitration role. What I was meaning was it would be good if it established itself as being, in the common view, authoritative and independent. much like the IFS is at present, so that if it pronounced on something, if it said, you know, the way things are going, the finances of the Scottish Government are going to decline by X percent over the next 10 years, then that was seen as being something which was serious and well-researched and which influenced the public debate, rather than just being as one side in the debate saying one thing and the other side in the debate saying something else. But I wasn't thinking of it having any sense of formal role.
I see. Thank you for the clarification, Dr. Cuthbert. I don't know if anybody else has anything to add on that point at all. Or...
Well, maybe if we need an independent arbiter, it should be Audit Scotland.
Well, opportunity to accept or decline the challenge, Mr. Taylor.
I think I'll avoid that opportunity just at the moment. Thank you. I think the one thing that we'd say here is transparency is important, but you can't take the politics out of this. And ultimately, there will need to be political negotiation and agreements about aspects of this. It's impossible to remove that. Of course, if the SFC, as we all hope, establishes itself as authoritative and independent, that will carry weight in those discussions, as indeed other factors will as well. But just a recognition that ultimately there needs to be agreement on those things. I think that's been demonstrated in the short term around the bulk grass grant adjustment in the current period, and the need for there to be a political agreement on that.
Just one final question, sorry, Commissioner, if I may. The evidence from Robert Chote, the indication appears to be that OBR produces forecasts, and there isn't really any other kind of anybody else producing forecasts alternative to those. And I wonder if we're getting, you seem to have suggested this yourself, Doctor, I wonder if we're getting a bit hung up on the idea of who produces forecasts and how many forecasts are produced. And the question is whether the accuracy and integrity of the forecasts that Scottish Government produced are properly interrogated. And that should really be the focus in terms of SFC, rather than whether or not they themselves are producing an alternative forecast. I just wonder what the panel's view on that would be. Perhaps start with Mr. Taylor and work back along.
If I could start with some principles, I think from our perspective, transparency, as I've said before, is important. There's an assurance role there about reasonableness, but also that fundamentally is to support scrutiny, and it's that scrutiny that the value comes from. And having that transparency, having that assurance process allows yourself as a committee and others to scrutinise and put forward alternative views on how robust all of the system is.
Yeah, I think we must remember that when Robert Short was talking about other units not doing forecast, it was for the fiscal side of things. I mean, there are other forecasting groups, obviously, in the UK that do macroeconomic forecasting who can offer alternative scenarios to OBR, for example. We don't have that in Scotland, and I think, therefore, we perhaps need an independent set of at least the macroeconomic forecast. And it follows if you're doing these, then you're as well to do an independent set of revenue forecasts as well, I think. Yeah.
My own view is that there is a danger of getting too hung up in forecasts. But on the other hand, because of the dearth of forecasts, maybe the Fiscal Commission should certainly have the capacity to do it and may decide to do it. But in my view, need not if you choose not. I think the important thing is the assessment going around that. I mean, to give an analogy, supposing one had some money to invest in the stock market, you wouldn't go along to a stockbroker and say, what do you forecast the market will be a year from now? And act accordingly. I mean, you might ask him what he thinks the market is going to be, but the really interesting thing will be what his assessment of the risks on either side and what the events might take place. And on the basis of that assessment, you would then form a judgment. And I think that we're in much the same position. Let's not get too hung up on forecasting. It's important, but let's take the broader picture and its assessment of the risks around about the forecast, which in many ways are more important.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard.
Just following up from that, what I take from some of your earlier comments, Professor MacDonald, and I may have misunderstood this, is that you saw potentially in the future the Fiscal Commission taking on a similar role to the OBR in becoming the forecaster for the Scottish Government or for Scotland as a whole. But given your comments just there about the fact that we don't have alternative forecasts in Scotland. We've got a dearth of forecasts on macroeconomics, certainly in comparison to the UK where there are a number. Wouldn't that make the argument that on those occasions where it might be justified by assessing reasonableness or even on a more regular basis, if the Fiscal Commission thought that was useful, it would be good to have a government forecast and a Fiscal Commission forecast, not least to inform debate, parliamentary and otherwise, on economic policy?
In principle, I think yes, but then we come back to the point that some of the committee members raised earlier about the expense of the whole exercise, that, you know, to have two units doing something very similar is going to be very expensive, presuming that both are funded from the public purse. So there would be that aspect to consider. I mean, I do agree with Jim that we shouldn't get too on the forecasting itself, and we've said this earlier, that as long as there is transparency in the assumptions used, that it is perhaps unnecessary to have duplication. But I think where it would become interesting would be if, and this goes back to the point that was raised earlier, that it's really for this, I think, the Scottish Fiscal Commission to decide if they want to set up their own model. But I think it would be interesting if they decided to set up a very different framework to the model that was being used by Scottish Government. Then I think there may be a greater case for allowing them to have a different kind of modelling setup, so that we do get two very different kind of forecasting models, which may, and I emphasise may, be able, one may be better able to address some of the uncertainty issues that, that Jim has referred to. But it's not a straightforward situation, obviously. But the other thing I would say is that one of the reasons we don't have alternative outfits forecasting the Scottish economy is that we don't have a very good data set. And, you know, this goes back to a point I made earlier, that I think as the data becomes better, as it surely must, if these forecasting exercises get underway, I think you will see independent forecasters in Scotland start to perhaps develop their own models. So there may be that scenario going on in the background, which may alleviate the need for two models, one from the Scottish Government, one from the Scottish Fiscal Commission.
And how quickly do you think we're going to be in a situation where the data is improved and more readily accessible? Is that happening now, and how do we get to that point?
Well, I think you had a piece about this in your last report, and as I recall, you questioned the civil servants on this issue, and I think they said it was a halfway house at that stage, so we're still some way to go. And I think that goes back to what I said earlier, that it's most likely that the initial models that the Scottish Government use will be relatively small and tractable models, because, you know, the data isn't there to provide for a fuller, more fleshed out model.
I mean, in that report we also highlighted some difficulties have been in terms of accessing data and getting data from different departments. Mm-hmm. I mean, Robert Chote didn't seem to be particularly concerned about the memorandum of understanding being on the face of the bill, but you said it should be actually in legislation itself. Is that something? Might you have a chance to reflect on Robert Choate's comments? Do you think that it being in the bill is still necessary, or is it simply more important, the fact that we've got a detailed and transparent memorandum of understanding there?
Yes, I think as long as there is a truly transparent and well thought through memorandum, whether it's on the face of the bill, I think it makes the Scottish Fiscal Commission more independent, more transparent, if it is in the bill, because essentially a memorandum of agreement moves you beyond a gentleman's agreement, and I think that's what you want to be doing in this case, really.
Thank you. Do either of the panellists have any views on access to data or developing more data, as President Ronald referred to?
I think one aspect which we shouldn't neglect is the role of the Office for National Statistics.
Sure.
Because insofar as the forecasting at some stage comes down to forecasting the Scottish economy, that's critically dependent on data from the Office for National Statistics. And they have had their problems over the past few years, and it's not clear that these problems are being sorted out rapidly. So, you know, it's not really within the hands of the Scottish Government, a lot of what's going on, and so there's an important implication there.
UK data and Scottish Government data, I think we're clear in our paper that we think the rights of the access in the bill are sufficient, and they're drawn broadly. And to have more detail and more greater specificity in the face of the bill, I don't think is necessary, because those rights of access are drawn broadly and we think they're quite powerful. I think a point to be made around an MOU with the Scottish Government and potentially Revenue Scotland and others is that, yes, I think it's helpful about transparency. Yes, I think it's also helpful that working relationships are clear and the way in which things operate. But I think care has to be taken to avoid a proliferation of such agreements, because often in practice they can dampen down potentially the rights of access that people like the Scottish Fiscal Commission have. So getting the balance right in how and how much detail everything needs to be specified, I think is an important consideration as the Fiscal Commission sets itself up on a statutory basis and begins to develop those sort of ways of working.
I think Cuthbert's made an interesting point around accessing data which isn't under the control of the Scottish Government or indeed this Parliament, and perhaps that's something we need to consider as we look convener towards the arbitration process on these issues in the future.
Okay, thank you very much for that, Richard, and that's... Jean, you want to come in?
No, we're just really on, I suppose, around the Barnett formula calculus and the Treasury itself. I mean, often we have these discussions, we've taken evidence from different members, but there's still a mystery around how that operates. And on the other hand, we want to show absolute clarity. And I just wonder if the word trust is needed somewhere too. I mean, presumably there has to be some element of trust between these different organisations and their relationships.
Yes, I think that's right. Trust and goodwill. And I mean, I think it's ridiculous, for example, that the Treasury has not produced the funding statement, which the funding statement is the fundamental thing which tells you for each Whitehall programme, if you like, what the comparability percentage is, which is the thing that drives, one of the key things that drives the Barnett formula. And that has not been updated for 5 or 6 years now. Mm. So, I mean, I think there's the current operation of the Barnett formula is not up to what it should be. And things are going to be much more complex in the future. So there really needs to be a step change in what the Treasury produces and how it goes about this aspect of its functions.
And are you hopeful that that can happen, that that will happen?
I really don't have an, you know, I don't have any insight into what goes on in the Treasury or in government. Mm. The little hints one gets suggest they're not being entirely cooperative or reasonable in current negotiations, but that's, you know, very much an outsider's view. I'm not optimistic given the Treasury's past record, but that's not an informed view.
Mm. Yes, well, I've said previously I don't like the lack of transparency with Barnett and would prefer, you know, to move away from Barnett for that and other reasons. Yeah, but I do take the point. Obviously, there has to be trust and there has to be goodwill between the relevant parties and cooperation.
I entirely agree that trust's important, but the operation of bodies like the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who, in my mind, his primary purpose is to help protect and engender that trust in how the system works, that trust of public that the public has in how the system works. Again, I think the key ingredients of that are transparency around how it works and as much transparency as possible, the assurance role that the SFC will have over that, and the scrutiny process that goes on alongside all of that. And I think those are key ingredients to that trust.
Mm. I mean, would you agree, too, that sometimes to try and legislate for everything can really introduce suspicion almost rather than if you're trying to come up, I mean, to a certain extent, should we assume a culture of trust when we are looking at the bill?
I think we're into deep water here about the whole operation of the United Kingdom post-referendum. I mean, it's not going to work if the thing is seen as opposing factions, not trusting one another, not cooperating. You know, if we want it to work reasonably, there has to be, in a sense, a goodwill. And how one achieves that necessary goodwill to make the system work, while at the same time, you know, politicians have quite legitimately different and inconsistent political aspirations, I don't know. I think that there is a major problem there. But unfortunately, the people who are liable to suffer is Scotland. If there isn't openness about how these funding things are working, then they're not going to be properly debated, they're not going to work equitably, they're not going to be evolved in the proper fashion. So, I mean, there are real dangers in here, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you. Now, that has concluded our questions. Do our panellists want to make any further comments before we wind up the session? Anything else you want to add that's not been covered? Okay, well, thank you very much for your evidence today. That concluding that session, I'll now have another short break to allow a changeover of witnesses. Again, give members a natural break.
I shall reconvene the session. Our third item of business is to take evidence on the Scottish rate of income tax from Professor David Bell. I'd like to welcome a former advisor, Professor Bell, to the meeting and invite him to make a short opening statement. David.
Okay. Thank you. I'd just like to start off by saying that I think this session of the Finance Committee and the associated papers are important because it will place on record the simple point that what you think you may get if you increase Scotland's income tax by 5%, say, is not necessarily what you will actually get. Multiplying the average additional tax liability by the number of Scottish taxpayers gives an arithmetic estimate of the extra revenue. The outcome may be quite different because this simple calculation does not take account of how taxpayers' behaviour may change if tax rates change. Changes in taxpayers' behaviour are difficult to predict. This is because it is really difficult to establish the, what we call the counterfactual. What would have happened had rates not changed? One finding on which there is agreement is that increases in taxes lead to reductions in taxable income. This could take a number of forms. Taxpayers may reduce their hours, drop out of the labour market, retire, or even emigrate. All of these responses will lead to lower tax receipts on other taxes as well as income tax. And that might have implications for the no detriment, second no detriment clause. Alternatively, taxpayers may reduce their effort at their workplace or negotiate higher wages to offset the higher taxes. That will lead to lower company profits. Finally, they may seek to avoid tax by reclassifying their income as, for example, profits. And this would lead to a transfer of tax receipts from Scotland to the rest of the UK. The group most likely to change their behaviours are the very highly paid. Scotland gets about 20% of its total income tax revenues from the top 1% of earners. This means that it faces considerable revenue risk if this group alters their behaviour. To me, this suggests that the Scottish Government have to proceed cautiously, call canny, when considering significant changes to the structure of income tax in Scotland. It is also worth bearing in mind that the perception of Scotland as a high tax jurisdiction not only might affect the behaviour of Scottish taxpayers, but also skilled migrants who might come to Scotland and have the potential to boost the Scottish economy. That's it.
Thank you very much. I think a couple of words actually you used there, David, were significant and perception. And I think it's the definition of what becomes, what is significant. I mean, for example, the committee had a 2-day study visit to Basque Country last week, and one of the first things asked the Minister for Finance was, given the fact that taxes are a lot higher in the Basque Country, what impact this actually had. And they kind of looked at us kind of bewilderedly and said, well, not really anything that they've been able to discern. Now, the Basque Country has a level of GDP 22% per capita above the Spanish average. It's got productivity 28.5%. above the Spanish average, a human development index higher than Norway, Sweden, Finland, etc. So they said, well, it's only 35 minutes by plane to Madrid, incidentally, from Bilbao, so it's even closer than London is to us. And yet they didn't seem to have had any adverse effect, and that was certainly their view. For them it was, and I quote, not an issue. Basque Country raises all its taxes more or less and hands pays 6.24% of all of Spain's taxes. So they've got a much higher level of devolution than we have or are likely to have in the foreseeable future. So that is why the issue is, I know labour elasticity is covered in your paper quite substantially, but where does it become significant? One could argue in the super rich that even a marginal increase could deter someone, but ultimately if you're looking to increase revenue, where is the XY-axis occur in your view in the UK context?
Well, we have quite a strange structure so that you pay 20% on income between about 10,000 and 42,000 and then 40% up to 150,000. The big action, it seems to me, is more likely to be down towards the lower end of the income tax schedule. If you, if you want to raise a lot of money, I think we raised around 700 million out of 11 billion from the additional rate. So even if you increase the additional rate a lot and there is no behavioural response, you're not going to get a huge amount of extra revenue. If you move the additional rate and have it kick in at 120,000, that would make a pretty significant difference. So I think you've got to think about both bands and rates. I think rates, in terms of your good point around perception, people see rates as the key issue, but bands are as important. And what you see, for example, in the Scandinavian case, and indeed what used to be the case in the UK, was that there was a much more stepped. The bandwidths, if you can describe them as that, were smaller. And then you moved up steps in a kind of smoother fashion than is currently the case. And it's in, you know, around or at lower incomes that you would actually have a big impact on tax revenues. Of course, you know, that has its political costs potentially.
Although what I think is also is good in your paper is the fact that you've included national insurance, so people can actually look at the real rate of income tax, because people often forget, you know, you know, that there's a, that when income tax goes from 20-40%, national insurance goes from 12-2%, so there's really a 10% or a 20% increase. But I think one of the things that you've talked about, and Gavin McEwen in his excellent paper also covers this issue, is the issue of migration. You say, and I quote, the flow of migrants into Scotland could be reduced if the higher tax rates, in addition to the social and psychological costs, deter immigrants. And just Professor McEwen says, and I quote in paragraph 4, in a 2014 paper, Anouk Berthe of Spice surveyed the evidence for tax-induced migration in Switzerland. Now, obviously, Switzerland and Sweden are not areas where you would expect, for example, to be any issue in attracting migrants if we look at very high migrant populations. And it says, while there is a federal income tax in Switzerland, it is relatively low, and cantons and communities have considerable taxing powers, including the right to tax income. She reports that two studies she consulted found evidence of high income taxpayers taking a level of taxation into account in choosing the place of residence. One found little such evidence. So there seems to be quite a divergence of views on this particular issue. You know, Professor McEwen talks about, the diversity of taxation throughout the United States with a whole plethora of corporation tax, sales tax, etc. And he says there is undoubtedly competition between authorities and influence on migration as a result. But diversity has been remarkably stable and even tended to increase somewhat. Now, if we look at pure economic factors and taxation, I think, you know, it's quite clear that taxes go up, migration you would expect to decrease. But what impact do you think the expenditure of these taxes actually has? So, for example, if I'm thinking of moving the wife and wains to somewhere, I'm not just thinking about a marginal tax rate. I'm thinking about what the schools are going to be like, what the public realm is going to be like, what the levels of crime are going to be like, what the relative cost of housing is going to be. So how impactful, really, are these marginal rates? If Scotland, for example, had higher tax rates, which seems to be your assumption, and one compares them to perhaps, you know, folk looking at Scotland just being a higher quality of life place in which to live?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's a very fair point, and one that I tried to cover in my paper a bit by discussing the forces that cause people to migrate or maybe not migrate. And typical pattern would be that it's the young who migrate, and the reason that they migrate is that they gain the benefits of taxation over the rest of migration over the rest of their lifetime. It tends to be the better off, higher earners who migrate, because the costs of moving mean less to them than they would to lower income people. And the costs of moving are not just the economic costs, they're the psychological costs, the social costs associated with moving from you know, somewhere where you, your children are established in school, where your wife has a or your husband has a settled social pattern with groups of friends and so on, all of that, you're thinking, if you're thinking of giving that up just to get a lower tax rate, it's not obvious that that necessarily will, you know, that the lower tax rate would make the big difference. And so I think that the evidence around migration is very mixed. There's one study that I would refer to where tax rates have been used as a specific policy to attract migrants into a jurisdiction, and the policy has been successful, and that's in Denmark, and that the paper there is Kleven et al. And what happened was that for a specific group of high earners, tax rates were lowered, and there was an increase of high income earning migrants into Denmark following the introduction of that policy. And quite a good counterfactual was established with earners who earned slightly less than the threshold at which the lower tax rates kicked in. Their numbers didn't change, but there was a big influx of the very high earners. Now, you know, there are a number of reasons why one might be sceptical about applying that argument to Scotland. I think it is a specific policy in a way aimed at attracting migrants, which, you know, I'm not clear how that would, I don't think that under the powers of the Scotland Bill as currently constituted, Scotland could offer a lower rate of tax to people migrating into Scotland and keep the same tax rates for residents. My understanding is that that wouldn't be a potential policy. So, you know, given that that may well not be applicable to Scotland, given that also obviously that the situation in Denmark is somewhat different from Scotland, it's not clear that that lesson would necessarily apply. Just one thing, at one point I would make though, is that in general it's true that the costs of migration probably have fallen in the last two or three decades, mainly because of the ease of international travel, the way that the labour market has become much more an international labour market than simply a national or regional labour market.
Okay, thanks. I mean, obviously migration is a key issue because, you've said, for example, page three, paragraph, at the end of that long section two, you said during the period 1950 to 2000, Scotland experienced net immigration of around 900,000. Obviously, that legendary union dividend coming into play again. But, I mean, when you go down to London, house prices are phenomenally higher, so younger people who want to go have got to somehow try and get on the housing ladder. My understanding is the schools aren't exactly top-notch for most people. Everything is more expensive, and so surely if we can deliver, assuming there are higher taxes in Scotland, a reasonable quality of life and a higher level of employment, more equality, all the things that we all want to have. And again, the Basque Country's got a very high level of index of equality, much better than anywhere else in Spain, above the EU average. Would it not deter migration on tax grounds? Incidentally, 29% of the Basque Country's population are immigrants, mostly, incidentally, from other parts of Spain, not from, you know, developing countries or whatever. So surely it's about what you do with the resources that you have, all else being equal.
Yeah, I mean, I think probably at the moment the cost of housing in London, for example, is a big, or deters potential emigrants from, let's say, the financial sector in Scotland to down south. On the other hand, if you are established in the London housing market, having a higher tax rate in Scotland might actually be a negative for moving up. People could adopt different strategies around that. I don't want to say that that would necessarily overcome the lack of migrants going down, but I guess while it's probably true that for most people the costs of emigration exceed the benefits, we have to be careful around even losing, well, it seems to me, a small number of high earners. You can take the view, well, that's it, but if the top 1% are paying 20% of total revenues, then I think you have to be careful.
Okay, well, say, let's look at it from another point of view. Say, for example, that whoever wins the election next year decides, no, do you know something, actually, we're really worried about, actually, the effect of higher taxes. We're really worried about losing some of these higher earners. So what we're actually going to do is we're going to reduce taxation. What would be the benefit to Scotland, would you say, of that? Now, obviously, we'll lose tax revenue and that will have an impact on our public services. What would be the economic impact? In other words, what I'm trying to ask you is it an equal relationship? Are people as likely to flow into Scotland if we reduce taxes as to leave Scotland if we significantly raise taxes? Is there any work being done on that?
No, not that I know of. I mean, what you would get is less of a fall in revenue than you would expect if you just did the arithmetic cost of... Yeah.
You never get as much.
So what you would lose less income tax revenue than you would expect. You might gain a bit of VAT revenue, but of course increased national insurance, the other part of VAT and most other taxes would, if their value is increased, then that money would just go to HMRC. And it is also important because to think about, well, where are these people going to come from? If they're coming from outside the UK, then that's a benefit to Scotland and to the UK taxpayer. If they're coming from other parts of the UK, then their increased VAT spend in Scotland, say, is mirrored by the reduction in VAT south of the border. So HMRC isn't actually better off or worse off as a result.
Say, for example, we reduce the higher rate by 5p or something like that, because we're all, the suggestion seems to be that if it weren't 5p, it would have a detrimental impact on people effectively classing themselves as Scottish taxpayers where they have a domicile in both locations. What I'm trying to say was, if we reduce it 5p, would the amount we gained offset the amount we lost? Because the argument seems to be that we wouldn't gain much by putting it up 5p, would we gain a lot by putting it down 5p? Down by 5p as a random figure, so to speak. That seems to be a figure which it's considered will have an impact. 2 or 3% doesn't seem to have quite the same level of impact it's perceived.
Okay, well, I mean, maybe I can refer to Manning's paper on what his view around the increase proposed by the Labour Party at the last election from 45 to 50. Was concerned. The arithmetic number was that UK tax revenues would increase by 3.3 billion. And his analysis, based on behavioural responses and effects on other tax revenues, was that there would be a range of between 2.8 at the top, depending on the elasticities, 2.8 was the most optimistic outcome, and a loss of 0.7 billion was the most pessimistic outcome. So you expect 3.3 if you just do the arithmetic, but in fact, there's a wide range because of the uncertainty, and the numbers are between minus 0.8 and plus 2.8. in terms of the effect. Now, I've no reason to believe it wouldn't be symmetric if you went in the other direction, so that you know you would probably gain what's that about 4/5 you'd lose about 4/5 of the tax revenue you expected to lose if you cut the Scottish rate from 45 to 40, say.
400 million by 2018-19, it was a rough prediction, SRIT. If we cut it by 5p, what you're basically saying is, now, obviously the higher rate's much less, but I'm just looking at for arithmetic. I realise what's probably about 70 or 80 million for those higher taxes. What you're saying is if we were cut it to 5p, you would lose 80%, you would still gain a fifth of the money that you lost.
Yeah, I mean,
say you lost 100 million or whatever the figure was, you would gain 20 million that back, so the net loss would be 80 million in terms of overall revenues.
It's really, really difficult to say. And I would, I think that at the UK level, migration hasn't really been an issue. But what has really been an issue is people avoiding tax. And Manning, for example, shows how, in terms of self-employed directors, there's a huge bunching of their wage or earnings at around just below £150,000, and then they're taking the rest as profits. Now, there's no reason that that reaction wouldn't happen in Scotland if you bumped rates up, and the reverse reaction might happen if you knocked rates down. And of course, actually, that affects the division of monies as between the rest of the UK, which will take its share of taxes on profits, and Scotland, which will be gaining only on the income tax.
A couple of points then, just to finish off before I let colleagues in. One is the fact that it's clearly the case that the lower you are down the income spectrum because of lack of mobility, the easier it is to either raise or cut your taxes with a surety of what the financial impact will be. I mean, very, very few, I'd imagine, basic rate taxpayers would leave if their tax went up. They might not be happy about it, but they couldn't do anything about it. So that money would be effectively within stay within the Scottish economy, and similar for probably people in the kind of middle spectrum. Would that not be the case? And if it was lost, there would be very little beneficial impact in terms of increased revenue. You know, folk aren't going to move to Scotland because the basic rates fallen or risen. Is that right?
So certainly migration, I think, wouldn't be an issue. I mean, it's then around basic work incentives and the question of how people respond in terms of the traditional sort of labour supply responses, like do they keep up their hours or do some people drop out? Now, there are questions, where you would then be, I think, raising questions would be around would people take retirement at a bit different time? Would particularly married women drop out because they have been shown in the past to be quite sensitive to tax rates. And then, of course, you get into the question of what kinds of rates are being applied to the lowest earners, the people who currently are getting tax credits. And so you have to do quite a complicated calculation to find out what rates they're actually facing and therefore what rates they might face depending on what happens to tax credits in the first place, but also what would happen if Scotland changed its tax rate. So I think it's the case that migration is not an issue for that group, but you'd have to be careful about changes in hours and possible withdrawal for the labour market as well. I should say that actually there's an article in the Financial Times the other day by Martin Wolf about the problems of the US labour market, and it has a much higher dropout rate than the UK. In fact, at the moment, the UK's very high level of participation in the labour market, even though that a lot of people are earning at relatively low amounts. But the US has really not registered the same benefits in terms of increased participation post the recession that the UK has. Scotland at the moment has its highest level of employment ever because participation rates are high. So you want to be sure that changes you might make towards the bottom end of the spectrum still give people an incentive to participate in the labour market.
Last question then, as you've said in your last paragraph, there's a strong case for moving cautiously when considering changes to the higher rates of income tax in Scotland, even though there may be no evidence that they have a detrimental effect on rates of economic growth in the long run, which I find quite interesting. It's almost as if saying that the economy will grow or not grow, whether these people are here paying taxes or not, which I find quite astonishing. Is there an optimum level then? Of taxation for higher rate payers, if you like, at which the economy can grow, we can obtain optimised revenue without people fleeing the country, so to speak.
There has been a huge literature on the optimal rate of tax, which is actually started by a member of the Council of Economic Advisers, Jim Merrilies. And I think it was on the basis of that work that he won the Nobel Prize. So there is a huge amount of work on that issue. And various I thought I might attempt to do some of the work on that particular question for this paper, but I didn't really get around to it. Yes, there is. And there are recent estimates that I can send to the committee, which are actually quite a bit higher than some of the rates that are being levied at the moment in the UK. One thing I would say is that looking at the long-run performance of economies, my last statement, the one to which you referred there in your question, I was thinking about Scandinavia and the fact that the Scandinavian economies have had very high rates of income tax for a very long time, but have not significantly fallen behind the rest of Europe in terms of economic growth. So,
Boyd talks about how Denmark across the board has got 12 or 13%. Higher levels of taxes, and that's borne by the population. But surely one of the reasons it's borne by the population in Scandinavia is that the disposable income that they have left after that, because their incomes tend to be generally higher, you know, purchasing power parity, leaves them with a reasonable amount of money in terms of their disposable incomes.
Yes, that's true. But also, you know, they have a very high level of public services, mm-hmm. and people buy into that notion that you know, this is part of the deal. So, you know, it's perhaps a somewhat different culture from one where you don't particularly value public services and you are much more concerned about your personal consumption. And that's really a cultural issue. And I think it's difficult to prejudge how that might work in the UK. But certainly, it doesn't appear to me that countries like Denmark have significantly suffered from having higher rates over the long run. You know, you might get a reaction in the short run.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. A number of people wanting to ask questions. The first will be Richard, to be followed by Deputy Convener.
Thank you, Convener. First of all, I remember being on a Scotland Bill Committee much earlier in this Parliament when we discussed the implications of full devolution of income tax. And then there was quite a discussion about, you know, the potential for predatory tax policy to cut the rates of tax in Scotland to attract high-income earners, and whether there would need to be, therefore, a policy agreement between the Treasury and the UK Government and Scottish Government to ensure there were agreements at that kind of policy wouldn't be pursued. So the fact that there's not been that agreement or not been those kind of tax treaties that there exist sometimes between states in America, doesn't that indicate actually that the received wisdom, if you like, is that migration just isn't going to be an issue, that, you know, it's going to be marginal, as a convener indicated, if it's going to be an issue at all. Or is it, you think, actually, that these matters will be covered by the no detriment policy that's been outlined in the current Scotland Bill?
I'm not clear how the no detriment will cover all the ramifications of the effects on the other taxes that I mentioned, the national insurance, VAT, corporation tax, and, you know, excise duty, fuel duty, if you like. And then the migration question, I think we're all guessing here. Where I would be most concerned is around, in the long run, the effect of not having people migrate to Scotland rather than people emigrating from Scotland. That would be my particular concern. And there, what matters, I think, is perception. If Scotland is, it may be a general perception rather than the detail of the additional rate being 47p rather than 45. If the perception is that Scotland is a high tax jurisdiction and that the public benefits don't offset the fact that taxes are high, then there could be a negative effect. But I really think it's very difficult to predict.
Sure, I accept that. But isn't it also the case that in terms of a European context, if we went to 47, for example, rather than 45, we'd still be behind France, Germany, Denmark, Sweden, and others. So, I mean, in a sense, surely there'd be a very marginal impact on perception. We talk about things like European migration, which has been very important for Scotland in the past few years.
Yeah, but I mean, it's also true that if you went to 47%, you wouldn't raise a heck of a lot of revenue. That's the downside. I mean, that might well be the case. But if you are going to change the amounts of revenue coming into the Scottish through the Scottish income tax, it does seem to me that you have to probably look a bit farther down the income spectrum as well to make big hits.
And finally on this, convener, I mean, I think the answer to most of these questions and predictions of what will happen if we do X on tax seems to be, well, we don't know really. But I mean, having said that, I mean, do you think there is enough modelling going on about the potential impacts of various tax changes? Could there be, I mean, is there any modelling, I suppose, is one question really, or could there be more modelling to inform, I mean, not just government policy in this issue, but public debate and parliamentary debate as well?
Yeah, that's a good question. Let me just say a little bit about this kind of modelling. The organisation that mostly does this kind of modelling is the Institute for Fiscal Studies. We're actually doing some work with them just now. But mostly, they talk about short-run changes, and they focus on the arithmetic effect of changes in taxes. And that's reasonable. So if they're analysing the budget and they're going to say 3 million people are worse off or better off or whatever, in the short run, the behavioural effects don't really kick in. So if you're thinking about next year, it's not the case that everybody will emigrate before next year. It takes longer. So there is work on behavioural responses. We've done a little, but what I guess we've done has been around just a general area. If we applied the Danish rates to Scotland, so you're making a big jump, an assumption there, and so anything you would give as a result certainly could be debated, but I would have to qualify it a lot by saying, well, you know, is it applicable in the Scottish context to use this? Now, I think, you know, there is a very good argument for doing more work just so that this kind of issue can be debated. But there's another issue that if you are focusing on the very top earners, and this harks back, I think, to your previous evidence session, there isn't that much information on this group. There are about 11,000 additional ratepayers in Scotland, and surveys just don't tend to pick them up. So doing the arithmetic calculations of the impact of taxes is difficult enough. Adding to that a behavioural response adds a further layer of difficulty. I'm not saying that it wouldn't be a good idea to try some of this, but it would have to be heavily qualified in terms of the results.
Thank you, Professor Bell. Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thank you. John, to follow by Mark.
Thanks, Convener. On page 2 of your paper, you talk about elasticity of labour supply, and I was struggling a little bit to get my head around this. I was just wondering if you could maybe explain, there was especially the bit about, you know, if you increase income tax, then real wages fall by 1%, workers reduce their hours by 0.5%, therefore the elasticity of labour is 0.5.
Just the ratio. So it's the ratio of how much the labor, the amount of labour supplied to, so what's the percentage change in the amount of labour supplied to the percent change in the after-tax income of the individual? So it's a ratio, so it's just a number. It doesn't have any dimension. So small numbers mean that there isn't much of a response. Large numbers mean high elasticity, very marked response to changes in the tax rate.
Right. So, but we are saying that if you increase income tax, you're always going to get less work done.
Yeah, that's so there I quote a guy called Mansky, who's really sort of guru on economic policy and all kinds of areas, and he says that there is no consistency on the estimates of the elasticity that I've just been describing, except that there is an agreement that if you increase tax rates, you will reduce taxable income. So the amount of...
Because some individual people, in order to maintain their income, will absolutely do more work.
Absolutely. Yes. And the theory says that's perfectly plausible response to changes in tax rate. If you want to keep your real income up, if that's what you really value, is high or your income, mm-hmm. then you will increase your hours of work, actually. And some people will do that, but on average, mm-hmm. the findings have been that people reduce their... And, of course, you can do that at what's called the intensive margin, which is hours of work, so you work less hours, or the extensive margin, where you just drop out, mm-hmm. so you don't supply any labour at all.
Yeah. Now, on page 10, in a slightly different context, but it says cultural acceptance of tax rate differences is probably country-specific. So are you arguing there that really there's quite a lot of differences between how people in one country, for example Denmark, and another country behave? Yes.
Absolutely. I mean, so you can see that there are pretty significant differences across the US. There are pretty significant differences across Canada, Switzerland, and Denmark. And, of course, I mean, this harks back to earlier remarks about, well, what maybe are the people in these countries getting in return for their higher tax rates? And maybe they just take the view, well, there's a compensating differential in terms of the public services that are being offered. And I guess what I'm saying is that we don't know the detail of that, so it's pretty difficult to take lessons from any of these countries and necessarily be able to apply them to Scotland. But it is worth noting that, you know, having differences in tax rates wouldn't make Scotland an unusual part of the set of developed countries in the world. Because differences in income tax rates are relatively common.
People's behaviour is not logical in one sense, or it's a different logic in different places?
Well, it's differences in the costs and benefits in different places. You know, what other taxes do they face? What's their response to differences in indirect taxes? it doesn't necessarily prove that they're illogical, but they may respond to incentives in different ways, and they may be facing other considerations like differences in indirect taxes and differences in the public services that are available to them.
I mean, it struck me that the bag tax, which is obviously a separate area, but, you know, 5p and yet I think an 80% drop in the use of bags was illogical, because most people are paying, say, £40 or £50 for their supermarket shopping, but they don't want to pay 5p for a bag. You know, and in the scheme of things, that does seem illogical, but sometimes people do react quite strongly to a very small thing, and I suppose that would be the risk here.
Yes. I mean, you know, so there are two kinds of modes of thought in economics. The second hasn't maybe got the appreciation it deserves, but the first is that people act logically all the time. And the second is comes from the area of behavioural economics, that people are influenced by all kinds of things and may not act in what seems to be their best interests all the time. That's behavioural economics, in which Stirling University is particularly strong. So I'm not trying to suggest that people will behave logically or in their own best interests at every juncture. I'm just saying that that adds further to the complication of trying to interpret what we see happening in other countries. And, you know, people may have a culture of working hard, and that actually supersedes the effect of changes in tax rates. So one of the things that Manning finds is that on the intensive margin, high earners don't change their hours of work much in response to changes in tax rates. Which means that, you know, if someone is earning $500,000 a year and the tax rate goes up by 5%, then that person will still put in the same amount of effort in their job, but they will spend more effort finding ways to avoid paying the higher tax. They will also put in some effort into that particular pursuit. So, you know, that might not seem a logical thing for them to do, but they maintain their work effort. That's a fairly uniform finding.
Okay, and well, I'm finding it increasingly difficult to try and predict what might happen, but I mean, you did say proceed cautiously, and I think that's probably good advice. I mean, could we pin that down? I mean, if I was to say, well, let's increase the rates 2p next March, April, and see what happens, would that be proceeding cautiously?
I guess that would be true. There's also the issue of signalling. So you might say, well, we're going to increase it by 5% over 5 years. And I think that kind of behaviour would precipitate action around the tax avoidance behaviour, because I think that was one of the things which happened in response to the announcement that the 50p rate would be taken down to 45p, was that the announcement of the tax itself had an effect on behaviour. But
no, like, it would be different to say, well, we're going to raise it 2p in April, and then we'll leave it sitting there for 5 years before we do anything else.
Yeah.
We'd be different from saying, well, we'll increase it by 1% every year for 5 years. Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. Okay, thanks so much.
Okay, thank you for that. Mark, to before by Jean.
Thank you very much, convener. First of all, you mentioned about the where people have moved income into profit or dividend income in order to avoid paying income tax on that income. And you said that a change in the tax rate, for example, might encourage or discourage that behaviour. But presumably that's only going to be true if the tax that is then paid on that income is lower or the same as they would pay on that if it were dividend income. So what kind of, you know, how far do you need to go in order to encourage that kind of behaviour?
Well, I mean, people who are probably in a position where that matters are high earners who can pay for tax advice. As I said earlier, if you look at a thing called the Survey of Personal Income, and you look at self-employed directors and where their pay is bunched, it tends to be bunched just below the £150,000 additional rate cut-off point. So I guess I take from that that people earning that kind of money are taking advice, and they've opted for paying corporation tax on the remainder of their income, whatever that might be. And of course, as soon as the two rates were the same, there would be no incentive to do that. You wouldn't see the bunching happening. How much the difference has to be, well, you know, you're offsetting the cost of your tax advisor that you have to pay to give you the advice about what to do. As long as you're ahead on the game, which I guess, you know, if you're earning £500,000, it's quite possibly worth your while to do that. So it's both the difference in the rates between corporation tax and the top rate of income tax, but also how much above the top band, the 150,000, your income actually is. So if you're at 151, you know, it doesn't matter.
Okay. I just wondered, one of the other ways, of course, that one of the other ways that tax variation could exist is at the other end, because obviously, although the personal allowance is not going to be devolved, there is talk of the Scottish Government having the ability to set a zero rate. So that's another way in which, you know, I'm not saying one way or the other that would be what happens, but that is another way in which tax behaviour can be manipulated, for want of a better term.
Yeah, that's true. I think that raises an interesting point, because even if you just do the arithmetic calculations, the IFS reaction to the budget kind of calculations, it's worth really doing those, because if your concern is around poverty or inequality, say, then changing the personal allowance may not necessarily have as big of an effect as you might expect. And that's partly because we usually look at issues like poverty or inequality not on an individual basis, but on a household basis, because it's households that are faced with the difficulty of putting food on the table or whatever. And then what matters is, are there two people in the household who would benefit from the increase in the personal allowance, or is there one person working, one person not working, different combinations? All of these kinds of things are possible. So, you know, you need to do a very detailed calculation to see if that would benefit people, as opposed to, say, reintroducing tax credits or compensating people for the loss of tax credits. And even without adding the behaviour, that kind of calculation is worth doing, because it gives you the picture as far as the household is concerned. You know, are we moving people above the poverty line, which is 60% of median household income? It's not individual income, it's median household income, as a result of changing the personal allowance. I'm not saying one way or the other that it isn't a good idea. How people will react to the change in the personal allowance, I'm sure there are studies out there, but again, there's always the problem of finding what the counterfactual is, what would have happened if people didn't, weren't subject to an increase in the personal allowance.
I guess the other question I had was, we've spoken about the sort of migratory impacts and potential migratory impacts, and I guess the question really is, you know, what in a population of, you know, just over 5 million, what qualifies as significant in terms of behavioural impact? Because for me, from my perspective, if only a small number of people are behaviourally impacted, either positively or negatively, is that really a significant impact, or are we talking about where those people are in terms of the amount of tax they pay has to be looked at in terms of the significance?
Well, I mean, just, you know, in terms of where people are, clearly that's important, and it is for HMRC to make clear or to be able to accurately determine where people are in relation to their tax liabilities. And from the news this morning, it's not clear that HMRC have been all that effective, for example, in pursuing people who apparently have been evading tax. In terms of the migration, you know, it's the short-run impact may not be all that much. If additional ratepayers pay in total about 700 million at the, or the additional rate contributes about 700 million to the Scottish revenues, then it might not seem to necessarily be all that negative to lose some top earners. But I think you have, again, to be careful, because these people may also be entrepreneurs. The fact that they move might have impacts on other parts of the economy. One of my big concerns about over the last 20 years of the Scottish economy is the loss of decision-making power at the top end of, you know, within Scotland. That certainly used to be there. The number of FTSE 100 companies that are located in Scotland has fallen over the years. So I'm fairly concerned about that issue. And then in terms of the longer run for migration, really the difference, or one of the main differences as to why the Scottish population will grow more slowly than the rest of the UK over the next 20 or 30 years is that we are forecast to have a lower level of net in migration. And over time that builds up. You know, the fact that around 900,000 people were lost in the about the 70s and 80s and so on, it is really massive in terms of what effect it's had on the Scottish population. I'm not saying, though, that a change in the tax rates is going to reverse what has been a trend towards in-migration into Scotland in the last 12 or so years, particularly since 2004. But migration is something that we have to be, I think, concerned about. But I don't think, you know, taxes is by any means the major issue around what determines the overall flows of migrants. It's more things like public services, perhaps, and quality of life and so on.
Sure. I guess the point I was trying to drive at was if you were to take the view that using the tax base, using the tax levels that you levy would attract people to Scotland, or flip side, drive people out of Scotland, at what point are the effects of that significant? So how many people would you need to take in for you to say you had the policy had a significant effect, or vice versa?
Yeah.
Is there a model that you could look at that would say if you attract, you know, 10,000 people on the basis of this, or you lose 10,000 people on the basis of this, that then has a significant impact?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that we do have a model that does that. And it would depend, you know, what kind of people they were in terms of what their average income was, and therefore what kind of tax contribution that they're making. Clearly, you know, if the Scottish economy is growing itself, then irrespective, it seems to me, of tax rates, then migrants will be attracted into the Scottish, into Scotland, just because there will be employment opportunities in Scotland, and there are plenty of people around Europe who already have taken advantage of the employment opportunities that are available in Scotland and have moved in the last decade or so. So again, you know, whether changes in tax rates would affect the overall pattern of migration is not entirely clear, because we won't be able to do what the Danes have done and offer a specific rate to people coming in. But it does seem to me that you have to be careful about losing or not gaining, you know, a group of high earners within the overall pattern of migration, because there's movement, gross migration flows, significant flows each year to Scotland and from Scotland. The net difference, around 10,000-15,000 a year, is roughly where we are with migration. It's unlikely, it seems to me, that differences in tax rates would make a huge difference to that overall net flow. But you've got to be concerned about whether the tax base or tax revenues, whichever way you want to look at it, is disproportionately affected by the migrant flow.
And just one last question. In terms of the how long you would need to look at this to accurately judge the impact, I mean, one of the criticisms that's been levied around the looking at the 50p rate, the way it was applied, is that because it was only applied for effectively 1 year, you couldn't really judge the long-term behavioural impact of that. I mean, you can only really forestall the first year that something comes into effect, but that maybe wouldn't affect those people who move towards profit. So how long a period do you need to assess a tax change or a tax policy before you can accurately judge its impact, would you say?
I mean, you need at least 3 to 5 years, I would think. Partly, at least, because, you know, you're not actually getting the information around the revenues, the overall revenues, until about 18 months after the year end, due to, you know, if we're talking to a large extent about to some extent about the self-employed, they complete their tax returns January after the end of the tax year. Then there's a bit of debate, so, you know, the accounts are not finished, and some of the debate around the 50p rate was actually being done in the dark, because they didn't even have that information available to them. So, it, you know, I think you're right. It's going to take what I would call a medium-term perspective before you really know what's happening, what effect a change in taxes have had.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Jean, to be followed by Gavin.
Just a very quick question, and it's around, the evidence when something has already happened. But in the early 80s, we were paying 33 pence in the pound, and due to political philosophy at the time or policies, that was changed over the next few years until the present 22 or 23 pence in the pound that we pay now on minimum. But what are there What evidence is there? Can you refer us to anything about that, or me? Because, in a sense, that's hard evidence of what happens when, for whatever reason, approved of or not, but when you reduce income tax. Now, I know that there's taxes went all sorts of other places and there were changes elsewhere. However, nonetheless, it did happen. And since then, there's been a real nervousness by every government to change that.
So there was a considerable shift in tax policy in the 80s. And that's really why looking at income tax on its own is only giving you a partial view of what was happening. High marginal tax rates were cut, and actually tax revenues didn't fall all that much. What did happen, though, was that there was an increase in indirect taxes, VAT in particular. And so the overall tax burden fell a bit, but not massively in for the UK's economy as a whole. And what has happened since then is that governments have continued to rely more on indirect taxes than on direct taxes. And this is partly because it's easier to collect indirect taxes than it is to collect direct taxes. So taxes on, by indirect taxes, what I mean are VAT, excise duty, and fuel duty, and a few others. That has a distributional impact because most people buy goods that are subject to VAT. Most people pay fuel duty. Most people will pay some excise duty and cigarette duty and so on. So in terms of real income, that tended to favour the rich relative to the poor, that shift towards direct taxes. But partly it was driven, and because it didn't just happen in the UK, it was partly driven by the fact that it was easier to collect indirect taxes than direct taxes. And of course, in the UK, it seems to me, and this is a difficulty, I think, for the Scottish government, is that income tax has become sacrosanct, and that increases in direct taxes in the last couple of decades haven't really come through income tax at all. They've all come through national insurance. And of course, Scotland doesn't have the power to vary national insurance. There have been reviews of what's happened. Notably, the Institute for Fiscal Studies has done that kind of work, and I'm happy to give the reference for that.
I think that's, thank you, that's very kind. I mean, just a small point, but on the basis that the increase in tax rates, people work less, on that basis, is there any evidence, again, going back to the 80s, to the 90s, where the tax was reducing?
Yeah, so the...
I mean, is the converse also true? But it's not, is
yeah.
it?
Well, whether things work in reverse is difficult to assess, but the evidence, for example, on married women's participation mostly comes from the 1980s and the big changes in income tax rates that happened over that time. The argument is that what evidence is out there, and it is all subject to qualification, is that full-time males tend not to vary their labour input, working time, very much in relation to tax rates. And the same is true of single females. Married females, it's a bit more doubtful, but of course that may have changed. You see, what the rules that may have applied in the 1980s or the observations that we may have had from the 1980s may no longer apply now, because the nature of work has changed so much, the ability to work at home, for example. So you can put in your hours at home. I guess I'm just saying this is all quite difficult.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Gavin.
Okay, just a couple of very brief ones. Professor Bell, you give us the example of Denmark using tax rates to attract migrants. I think Cleven was in the other study. Do you have some idea of the sort of magnitude of tax change that was used in that case?
I've forgotten, but it was fairly considerable, but the response was also pretty considerable. I'll send you the... I know the elasticity was about 1.52, which is very, very high. Yeah. But I've forgotten what the initial change was, and I'll send that to you.
Okay, thank you. The question of the 45p to 50p rate has been raised a few times, and I think in your paper, you're quoting somebody else, but in your paper you basically say it's not possible to measure how much extra tax would be collected. I think what we know for sure is that the static costing will be wrong. That won't happen in practice. But surely having seen it happen and then having seen it being removed once in each direction, we must have some idea of the behavioural response we would expect if it were to happen again.
I think we should know that very soon. I was quite surprised that Manning's paper, which was produced just before the election, didn't actually have the numbers for the for what actually happened in terms of how much additional rate was collected. But that must be available.
Okay. Just for clarity, just the point you made in response to Mark MacDonald, you were talking about being slightly cautious about playing about with tax rates too much, too quickly. In terms of migration, you said the flows could remain the same in each direction, and so you could end up with net migration being exactly the same with a changed tax rate. But your point was that the composition of those flows could change. So let's say you put tax rates up dramatically. Are you saying, well, the overall numbers of people might remain broadly similar if lots of people who are high-rate taxpayers are leaving and lots of people coming in are not high-rate taxpayers, and the impact on the public finances would be...
Well, you see, the current pattern is that if you take, just for example, the average age of migrants, average age of migrants out of Scotland tends to be lower, I think, than the average age of in-migrants. So the young leave Scotland and somewhat... not necessarily much, but a bit older people on average are coming back. So that will be made up of quite a lot of young migrants coming to Scotland, but also people retiring into Scotland. And as you say, how, you know, what proportion of that group are responding to the changes in tax rates is quite important, because it will affect the demands for public services and the level of revenues that the Scottish Government is collecting.
Helpful, thank you. Okay. Thanks, Gavin.
Just one final point for me before we wind up, and it's basically looking at Gavin's paper. In paragraph 7, he refers to a study by Maguire and Rubin. It says that house spending is correspondingly reduced matters. Thus, tax cuts leading to reduced spending on services which impact on businesses such as education may have an offsetting effect on business location and economic growth. And again, Gavin goes on in paragraph 11 to say, the general conclusion is that states wishing to foster entrepreneurship should focus on creating a stronger business climate and economic growth rather than on tax policies. So what I'm saying is that if you actually reduce taxes, you know, it can actually have a detrimental effect. But the taxes overall, again, referring to the point that you made in the last paragraph of your own submission, don't necessarily affect overall long-term economic growth.
I think that's probably true. So tax is one consideration among many when you are thinking about locating, if you're thinking about locating your business. I think I have some kind of a small amount of evidence that suggests that companies think pretty carefully about, for example, moving people around. If they're an international organisation, they've got people working for them in different parts of the world. And I think already some companies are thinking about how they might compensate employees if higher rates of taxes were paid in Scotland, or I guess pay them less if taxes were lower in Scotland. That kind of tax planning, I think, is some of them are thinking of that. But in terms of locating a business, the company itself will make an assessment of how important it is for their particular type of employee to have a lower or higher rate of tax and may make compensating adjustments, but then we'll look at all of the other costs and benefits associated with the jurisdiction they're thinking of moving to. And of course, in Scotland's case, that would be free education, free health, and all the public services.
Okay, thank you very much. Any further points before we wind up the session?
No, I think that's...
Well, thank you very much for your responses and indeed for your paper. Thank you very much. And also thank you to Gavin for the excellent paper he also produced. The committee previously agreed to take the next item in private. I therefore like to close the public part of the meeting. Just have a short 2-minute break and then we'll get on with the rest of our agenda.